This is Dan Schneider, and on this edition of the Dan Schneider Video Interview, I will be talking about the life and career of Rod Serling with his daughter Ann Serling and two experts on the man's life and career, Mark Olshaker and Mark Dawidziak, and we will be doing that in just a moment. All right, well, let's begin this show, and I'll introduce the three panelists again. You will see Ann Serling. She's the daughter of Rod Serling, and she wrote a book some years ago about her father, and we'll talk a little bit about that. And then there are two men, Mark Olshaker and Mark Dawidziak, who are also experts on the life and career of Rod Serling. So let me open up with Ann. If you could just tell a little bit about yourself and your father and what you've been doing in the years since his death and, you know, in promoting his legacy.
Hi, Dan. I was an early childhood teacher, but I've always been interested in writing. And I wrote my memoir as I knew him, my dad, Rod Serling, in 2013. The paperback version came out in 2014. I had originally started another book after my dad died called In His Absence, because I was trying to navigate that whole minefield of grief. But I couldn't complete that book because I was still quite distraught. So this book, As I Knew Him, took about 6 or 7 years to write. And I'm currently working on a novel called Aftershocks.
Were you an only child, or do you have siblings as well?
I have an older sister.
And did you grow up in Hollywood? Because your father was quite well known back in the day.
I was born in Greenwich, Connecticut, and we moved to California when I was about 3 years old, as live television died. They said all the writers moved west. So we lived in Pacific Palisades, which is about 20 minutes west of Los Angeles.
Okay, let me move on to Mark Olshaker. Mark, if you could tell me a little bit about your background in general in regards to television or the writing industry, and also specifically related to Rod Serling and how you know Ann.
Sure. I am a professional writer and television producer. I do books, both fiction and nonfiction. We're working on the 15th published book right now. And I've done many documentary films, mostly for PBS. And one of the reasons I'm a professional writer today is because of Rod Serling, who in my teen years I idolized along with The Twilight Zone, and got to meet him when I was 14. And because of his personality and his generosity and the kind of wonderful guy he was, we became friends, and so I knew him and looked up to him and considered him a mentor for what became the last 10 years of his life. And I do believe that I am the kind of writer that I am today, both fiction and nonfiction, because of him.
What sorts of documentaries do you do? Things for like Frontline or American Masses, American Experience?
Not Frontline, but Nova, which is also up at WGBH. I've done a number of shows on all kinds of different topics, science, crime. I spend most of my time now working on true crime. I've written a series of books beginning with Mindhunter, with the FBI's behavioral profiling pioneer, John Douglas, that have sold very well, and I'm currently working on a book on the other subject, which I seem to specialize in, public health. I'm writing a book with a very prominent epidemiologist about what the infectious disease world is going to be like post-Ebola, and that's actually as scary as anything that we've seen on the Twilight Zone. And as far as how I met Anne, it was almost Twilight Zone-like. I went up to a conference and introduced myself. We were on a Serling conference at Ithaca College in Ithaca, New York. I introduced myself to Anne. She thought she knew my name, and Anne can tell the story after that. And we just, again, became fast friends very, very closely. She's like a sister to me now. And There's something about the Serling family that just connects.
Okay. One of these days I plan on doing an interview show on documentary makers. I'll see if you can want to sit in on that one as well.
Sure.
I had actually done a written interview with a fellow named John Grabowski. I don't know if you've ever heard of him. He's a nature documentarian who's done some PBS documentaries. But Mark DeWidziak, let's get a little background about you and your relationship to the other Mark, as well as Anne Serling, and your interest in her father's work and legacy.
Well, I've been a theater, film, TV critic for about 38 years. So the work of Rod Serling, I'll echo what Mark said. I'm a writer today probably because of two writers, Mark Twain and Rod Serling. Mark Twain, can you tell? So I came under the influence of The Twilight Zone as a young man. And as with Mark Twain, I got to know more about the man when I was in high school. And as I learned more and more about the man, you got to learn that in addition to this great writing, which is what really initially draws you in, both with Mark Twain and Rod Serling, but then you read about their lives and you realize these were heroic individuals. And I've said this before, you know, but this was the first time I got the idea that a writer could be heroic. And I happen to think that the life of Rod Serling, like the life of Mark Twain, is in many ways heroic. And so they became heroes, role models for me. And I don't think it's any understatement to say I'm a writer today because of these two very American writers. I've written about 15 books, and the next one is going to be on The Twilight Zone, the one I'm working on right now, which Anne knows about because she's going to write the foreword for it, is on The Twilight Zone. And I've always felt that this was the book I was owed. When I was first starting casting about to write a book in the early 1980s, I wanted to write a history of The Twilight Zone. Mm. And Mark Scott Sacre beat me to it. And
oh, I've heard the name of it, yeah.
Couldn't even be all that angry about it, excuse me. All that angry about it because he did such a pioneering job on that book that I had set my sights on another book. So I wrote a history of the Columbo series instead.
Yeah.
And my goal in writing that book was to write a book as good about Columbo as he had written about The Twilight Zone. And I've written several other books of film history. I've written fiction, nonfiction, plays, a little bit of everything. If I could stick to one thing, I'd be successful, basically.
Well, we'll get to Rod Serling's importance in a little bit in terms of television writing, but I obviously he's up there as considered maybe one of the founding fathers of screenwriting along with Paddy Chayefsky. And this is the third straight week that I'm doing a show on American artists. I had done one on Eugene O'Neill and then last week on Stanley Kubrick. And certainly I think in the medium of television, Serling is as important to early television as O'Neill is to modernism in American theater, or Kubrick is to American film. So
absolutely.
Anyway, yeah. So let's actually talk let's talk in more general terms, just for the uninitiated, because a lot of people who will be seeing this on YouTube or any other venues, you know, Rod Serling died 40 years ago. I don't know if it's 40 years to the day or whatnot, but in 1975. So there's going to be a couple of generations that grew up that have only seen maybe some old Twilight Zones, maybe have seen the old Twilight Zone magazine. If Anne or one of you want to just step in and just give a sort of brief overview for 2 or 3 minutes of the man and his input. We'll get into a little bit more detail in our next segment of his actual life and World War II and that kind of thing. But if one of you could tell me just about really the impact that the Serling had on the fledgling medium, especially of screenwriting for television.
I think Mark ought to start with that and then we'll jump in.
Okay, Mark.
Sure. You know, first off, you have to understand the time. The fact that television in the 1950s was the Wild West. It was a wide open medium. All things were possible. And they were doing things with very little resources. And the word had gone out for most of the Hollywood studios, do not have anything to do with this new medium. Your contract will be torn up. So they had to make their own stars. Television is a new medium. couldn't rely on established stars. They were being told, don't do television. And one of the things they did very smartly was to create stars out of the writers.
Yeah.
You would actually see introductions saying, this week, a new drama by Patty Chayefsky. This week, a new drama by Rod Serling. And people look forward to that. I mean, how much could you even do that today? Can you imagine that today? Somebody saying, you know, a new drama. Who cares? Who cares?
Let me add something to that, Mark. Tad Mozell, who was another one of the original generation, once said to me that he heard that kind of announcement going out, and said, and in 2 weeks, a new drama by Tad Mozell. And Tad looked at the screen and said, if I finish it. So
right.
It was literally that immediate. And Mark, I think you could probably speak to this, that this was really, and I really became aware of this when I was writing the introduction to the new publication through Rod Serling Books, of Requiem for a Heavyweight, that this really was a hybrid between movies and stage, with some taken from both, but it really was, they called them teleplays for a reason.
It had the energy of live theater, because they were pretty much doing it live, and it had the grit, the emotional and intellectual grit of the theater as well. But it was something unto itself.
Yes.
That's the amazing thing about the live drama. And if you go back and you look at this moment where it arrives, it really solidifies television as a new medium. It justifies it. It shows that this is a legitimate form. And it is not quite theater, and it is not quite movies,
right,
but it's something unto itself. Walter Kerr wrote an essay because... Walter Kerr was a man of the theater, and he loved classic movies. And he said he was late coming to television because he looked down on the medium. And people said, no, 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 you have got to see some of these live dramas that are being done. And finally he saw one, and he wrote an essay. It's an amazing essay. And he said, this is how I knew this was a legitimate new medium, because I realized that if you missed it, you could not make up this experience anywhere else on the cultural landscape. When you can say that, you have a legitimate art form. And he realized television had come of age. And the two principal practitioners who brought it of age were Patty Chayefsky and Rod Serling.
Yeah, and it should be noted, Mark, let me just say, that Rod Serling, more so than Patty Chayefsky's, was all over television even before the Twilight Zone. I think he did guest shots on Jack Benny. I think he did a guest shot on one of the Lucille Ball series, as a guest. So I mean, this was a writer that was one of the, you know, most I guess they call Q rating, had one of the high Q rating kind of things that you're not going to see today.
I made that point in the introduction to Patterns, the reprint of the four screenplays, Rod's first book, which Rod Serling Books reprinted. And I made that exact point, which was Rod Serling, because of television, was something which is very, very rare for a writer. He was a celebrity. He was a 40-carat celebrity, meaning you could show Rod Serling's face to people on the planet, and they would know who it was. They would recognize him. Nobody recognizes writers.
Yeah.
I mean, maybe today Stephen King or somebody like that. But, you know, a writer can walk down the street and be anonymous. And in American literature, we're going to go back to Mark Twain for a second. The only two writers who were genuine celebrities, meaning they were recognized on the planet, around the planet, were Mark Twain and Rod Serling. Mm-hmm. They were conspicuous Americans.
I think that's very true. And Anne has often said that she and her sister used to resent when the public would take over their father from her.
Yeah.
Right. The reason my dad was actually not going to be the one that would be introducing the Twilight Zone. It was somebody else whose name I can't remember. And then they wanted Orson Welles who proved to be too expensive, so my dad volunteered. But that's, that was the celebrity status. That's why he, became so well-known, because he did become the announcer. But to what you said, Mark, sometimes we did resent it because people would come up to him and know who he was. But as I wrote in my book, the paparazzi, years ago, was nothing like it is today. It wasn't in your face, rude, offensive. But my dad was always extremely gracious to his fans and anyone that wanted to talk to him. And they remember that. People have said that to me today, how kind he was and how he stopped and he took the time to talk to them.
Well, it's interesting. I was just looking at your face, Anne, when you were listening to the two marks. There's a famous photo of your father sort of looking off to the left, and you had that exact same look. I could see the resemblance. Well, let's end this segment. When we get back, let's delve a bit more into Rod Serling's early life, his youth, his stint in World War II, and how that affected him and his rise in the 1950s into the television medium. And we will continue in a moment. All right, we're back, and we're going to talk now a little bit more in depth about the early life of Rod Serling. And your father's name was actually Rodman, which is now sort of been co-opted by the former basketball player Dennis Rodman whenever I hear that. But it's an unusual name. You'd think it would be Rodney, short of for Rod. But there was a famous, I think in 1959, right before the Twilight Zone, there was a famous interview your father did with Mike Wallace, where I think he describes himself as this scrawny little Jew from upstate New York or whatnot. And it's one of the more, and we'll talk about it a little bit later, but it's one of the more extraordinary and in-depth interviews that can be seen, because your father is really scathing about the medium that gave him fame. But as I said, we'll talk about the specifics of that later. Let's just talk a little bit about your father, his youth, his family life, any siblings, and the first 15 or so years before he did go off into World War II, if you can, Anne.
Sure. My dad was born in Syracuse, New York, and he moved to Binghamton when he was about 2 years old. His dad worked for his father-in-law in the meat market and was a butcher. My father would have described his childhood as very idyllic. The episode Walking Distance is certainly autobiographical.
From the Twilight Zone, just so people know.
Yes. Of course, when he went off to war, that changed. When he was in the war, his father died at 52. And even though the war was over, my dad didn't have enough points to go home and for the funeral. Yeah. So that was another trauma on top of the war. But again, his childhood, growing up in Binghamton, small town, every summer, actually, when we have a cottage here in upstate New York, and every summer my dad would drive back to Binghamton and drive by his old house. It was an annual pilgrimage that he would take.
It's interesting, because some of the most affecting writing your father did, both for Twilight Zone afterwards and in the teleplays, generally evolve, I think, around three topics: those involving prize fighters, those involving people looking to get back to an earlier, simpler time, and those involving World War II or war in general. Those seem to be the sort of three touchstone issues that some of the best episodes of the shows and some of the best live plays dealt with. Mark, if you want to comment anything about Rod Serling's youth.
Yeah, I would say what Anne said is absolutely true. One time several years ago, Anne and her husband Doug and I and my wife Carolyn, we went back to Binghamton, went back to Rod's old house, traced the area where he would have lived, hung out, ridden his bicycle into the park where there is a carousel. And it really was like walking distance, wouldn't you say, Anne?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And he did have an idyllic childhood, or at least by his perception. And that all changed with the advent of World War II. And I would say both his childhood and his experience in war became hallmarks, as you say, and stayed with him both personally, spiritually, and in terms of his material for the rest of his life.
He told a writing class, actually, that he had a propensity to write about nostalgic themes. And, of course, boxing was something that he did to earn money before he went off to the Philippines.
Oh, he was actually involved in boxing before the war.
Yes.
Got his nose broke. And I would add one thing to that. One is that, you know, we keep saying he was in the war. There's no way to overstate that. He was a paratrooper in the South Pacific, which is, as hellish an assignment as somebody could have. The war is such a profound influence on him that later on, when he becomes an anti-war, a very outspoken, anti-war, eloquent voice for anti-war sentiments, it's based on up close and personal experience, which can't be in any way diminished because of where he was, what he experienced, and what he saw. And I would add one other thing about what Rod wrote about. There is another area that's very, very equally as important as the three that have already been mentioned, is that a lot of Rod Serling's writing is about age and people facing moral decisions at certain points of their age. And you can go through his entire career, starting with Patterns, which is about that, which is about, you know, when do we throw people away? When do we throw experience away?
And the same thing with Requiem for a Heavyweight.
Mm-hmm. Same thing with Walking Distance. Mm-hmm. Same thing with Last Stop at Willoughby. All the way into the Night Gallery when they're tearing down Tim Riley's bar. This is a theme he goes back to. And he keeps. I think he would have kept examining that theme throughout his entire life. If he'd lived to be 75, he would have still been looking at that, re-examining those themes which were introduced in Patterns.
And I can tell, even in his later years, which were his mid to late 40s, he was already looking back on things and how he missed the old days. And by our standard today, he was a very young man at that point.
His own father died when he was 52. So there, you know, he may have been thinking that, you know, there was a genetic predisposition too.
Was Rod Serling... you said he's outspoken politically within his work. Was he someone who took up causes? Did he march in like Selma, Alabama, or anything like that with the civil rights marches? Or
he was extremely outspoken and absolutely fearless. Prejudice was the greatest evil in the world as far as he was concerned. And when Anne was writing her book, I introduced her to a man who unfortunately has passed away named Mike Newman, who was a classmate of Rod's at Antioch. And Mike told us a story that neither one of us, I think, had heard, Anne, that there were two barbershops in town. And this would have been in the late 1940s, two barbershops in Antioch College in Ohio. And one of them refused to cut the hair of black people. And Rod absolutely railed against this, and he would not let anybody he knew at the university go to this barbershop. So that's just an early example of what became a lifelong hallmark. And I have to underscore and agree what Mark Dubiziak said, which is that he was heroic in this.
Where did his sense of outrage of this thing come from? Was it based in religion? Was he a religious person, or was it something that political views that developed early in his youth? Was his family like ultra liberal, or was it just something that, you know, the war influenced these opinions? Where did that part of his worldview come from? Does anyone know?
I think he was inherent in his makeup, Anne, don't you?
Well, his own father told him that he didn't feel that he was a very good Jew, but that he was a good man, and that he didn't think it mattered where somebody went to go and pray, as long as they were a good person. And I think that, you know, really became a part of my dad's makeup too. Although my father was fiercely proud of his Jewish heritage, actually his first dose of prejudice came from his own people when he was blackballed from a Jewish fraternity for dating non-Jewish girls.
Well, let's move on to now post-war. How did Rod Serling's writing career begin? Did he do the very early television shows even before Playwrights? Did he write for any, like, you know, Sid Caesar show? Did he, how did he get his entree into things?
Well, one word, Cincinnati. the training ground for Rod after he got out of college was really this kind of it's like a stand-up comedian. They always used to say you have to have some place where you can go and be bad. You have to go to some place where you can go and be able to try your wings out and fail and see what works for you and work things right, develop your style. And I think for Rod, the baptism by fire was when he went to work at a station in Cincinnati. And in those days, local stations did live dramas, original dramas. They did all sorts of things. And Rod really got a chance to write a lot during that period. That's a period that's not as studied, as concentrated on as other periods of his life. But you've got to start the whole thing in Cincinnati, because I think without Cincinnati, you don't get to the next step. You don't get Rod Serling, because this is the door. He takes all those experiences growing up in Binghamton, the war experiences, the college experiences, he packs his bags, and he goes to Cincinnati. And Cincinnati is kind of the door that leads to the live dramas of the 1950s. And you agree with that?
Yes, I do. I also... A little bit to that, I think it's interesting that when my dad got out of the war, he was going to major in phys ed because he liked working with kids. He was going to teach phys ed, but he was so traumatized by the war, that's when he switched to language and literature and the writing. But in the radio days, he would be the writer, the actor, and the producer of those radio scripts. So
he wasn't the stereotypical guy after the war, like a Norman Mailer trying to write the great American novel. He plunged headfirst into this newer media.
Mailer in a lot of ways. He came out of the war very affected by that. There are interesting, you mentioned Norman Mailer because he was the other writer who I became quite friendly with. Both, interestingly enough, New York Jews of Lithuanian descent, both ended up fighting in the Philippines as enlisted men in the war, and both became, in a way, touchstones of the 50s and 60s generation, a generation which I think we can say believed was idealistic enough to believe that anything was possible and cynical enough to believe that nothing was true. And I think that a lot of that came from our grounding in the Twilight Zone.
So in the early 50s, there's a lot of these live programs going on, 60 to 90 minutes. How long did Serling have to, you know, send around scripts to, you know, to get produced? Because there was probably, from what I've read, you know, maybe between 600 to 800 hours worth of live drama going on yearly with the then three networks, with CBS, NBC, and Dumont. I don't think ABC was considered a network at that time. So how long, first actual produced teleplay of his?
Well, I know, I'll let you guys speak to that, but I know that he had 40 rejections before he was finally accepted. In fact, someone told him that he ought to switch professions because he'll never become a writer.
Mark, it was really the Dr. Christian contest that put him on the map, wasn't it?
That's right, yeah. That was the one that sort of brought him to the attention of the New York set. Before that, he was basically a regional writer, a Cincinnati writer. And even there, what really gets things going is, I'd always like this, is that, you know, the thing that really puts Rod on the map is Patterns. I mean, you know, before Patterns, you know, Rod is struggling. He's writing scripts. He's selling scripts. It's a week to week experience as far as his livelihood is concerned. Patterns, and there's just no way to sort of talk about this kind of rocket like moment of arrival when Patterns airs. You can almost see collectively, you know, the hair rising on the back of everybody's neck. Like, what in the world is this?
And what was the date on that, Mark?
Now, you were going to ask that. I'm going to have to, so you think that would be, you know, in my brain. Andy, you know that?
It's 1955 that I'm looking up. I don't know the exact date.
I'm not sure.
But if you look at Rod, you know, getting out of the war in 45, and Patterns airs in 55, you know, a nice round 10 years. And all of a sudden, Patterns is this moment of, oh, you know, overnight success, you know, overnight success. Yeah, the overnight success took 10 years. The overnight success took 10 years. It was a 10-year process of getting out of the war, going to college, deciding to become a writer, going through Cincinnati, writing all those scripts. And it was a lot of work that went into Patterns. I think everybody kind of thinks Patterns came out of nowhere and all of a sudden it established him as a writer. It did not come out of nowhere. It came out of a lot of years of hard work and recognizing that this new medium had possibilities.
Now, keep in mind also that from the time that Mark just talked about in 1955 till the time he died, it was only 20 years. I mean, this man was like a comet on the public media scene. And the fact that we are talking so long for now 40 years after his death about his great accomplishments, those all came within a 20-year period.
Not only a 20-year period, but he manages, you know, the great line of, you know, there are no second acts in American lives. He manages three acts in those 20 years.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to.
Go ahead.
He actually wrote about 252 scripts until 1975.
Including 92 for The Twilight Zone alone.
Out of 156, yeah, he wrote 92 of the episodes.
Patterns, he had
not anticipated, you know, that it would get this success. And the story is that my mother was pregnant with me at the time, and they left my sister with a babysitter, and they said, don't worry, nobody's going to call. And my dad's story was that, you know, once it aired, the phone never stopped ringing. So, but he was stunned.
Yeah. And it should be just for people to know, Patterns was basically the story of a rise in a corporation of a young fellow who's asked to do some unethical things. And I think he refuses to do them and the ethical compromises he makes. So it's one of those things that I think put people off, because most of these shows were, you know, the so-and-so company, the Chrysler Company Playhouse 90 or whatever it was. And so it's almost like it was an attack against the very kinds of entities that were subsidizing the medium. So that in itself is pretty ballsy.
In this case, it was Kraft that was the sponsoring company. And it also hit home because the central character in Patterns realizes very quickly that he has been brought in to replace an older character who has been ground to dust by this process.
Yeah.
And when he realizes this, he realizes he has a responsibility to himself and to his talents, and yet he has a responsibility to his fellow human beings. And this puts him in the middle of a moral dilemma. And it's extraordinarily powerful. Like I said, this is a theme which you're going to see Rod. And, you know, and I think that's one of the reasons we're still talking about him.
Absolutely.
Is the fact that everything that Rod seemed to write about is relevant today. Everything he talked about, we're dealing with today, and that goes for the early dramas, television dramas. It's not just The Twilight Zone. There's a relevance to what Rod wrote that speaks to us and will continue to speak to us. And I've said this before, but there are certain writers who you read their writing and it dates.
Yeah.
You try to read a writer from the mid-1800s. You try to read Emerson. Anybody try to read Emerson lately?
Yeah.
You know, it's hard to relate to some writers from that period.
Yeah.
But there are certain writers whose writing seems as fresh as the day it was written. And it seems to continue to speak to generation after generation after generation. And that's one of the reasons we're still talking about Rod Serling.
And I think just to follow up on that, you know, people, I always tell young kids are in a golden age where they can get all the writings free on something like Project Gutenberg. And I think Rod Serling falls into that American category of writer. You mentioned Mark Twain. I would put him in the same kind of category of an Ambrose Bierce. I would put him in the category of someone like Stephen Crane as well. People who wrote about very specific things that are human and not always what the society at the time wanted to really look at clearly. And yet those are the writers that that don't date, I think. You know, it's the writers who are writing just sort of around the edge, the little pop cultural nuances that 20 years from now you're like, oh, they're the ones that don't last. But there was about a year and a half period between Patterns, which was the first big success, and then the other really sort of towering success of Requiem for a Heavyweight. And I read, I remember about a year or so ago, probably maybe about once a month or even more often, a Rod Serling teleplay was being aired, and it seemed that the critics always wanted Patterns to be, you know, redone. And so talk a little bit about some of, if you can, some of those plays in between Patterns and Requiem for a Heavyweight, and the frustration that Rod Serling might have felt.
Well, I don't know if it was frustration, because he was successful after that point, and as Mark very correctly points out, he was on the map as soon as Patterns came out. Requiem for a Heavyweight, which was the second production of the celebrated Playhouse 90, was the same kind of story. It was about somebody who has been used up and aged out, and yet it was based about simple, basic humanity, and these are, and morality, and these are themes which Rod stayed with throughout his career. Other plays that he did around that time, The Rack, which took place in a courtroom, essentially, about someone who was accused of collaborating with the North Koreans during the war, was equally morally sharp. And so he had already achieved by this point, or would soon, the title of Angry Young Man. And he was both young and angry, and he always had a moral point of view, which he was not shy about sharing.
I'll add on The Rack. Everything he wrote between Patterns and Requiem for a Heavyweight, the critics were looking for another Patterns.
That's
and
true.
The thing that he kept hearing and he got very frustrated with was when they would say, well, this is good, but it's not up to Patterns. It's not up to Patterns. And he's like, well, you know, that does become the frustration. It speaks to the importance of Requiem for a Heavyweight. I think Requiem for a Heavyweight proved to himself, and to everybody else for that matter, that he wasn't a one-hit wonder. Yeah. That, you know, it's the 1-2 punch of his guy. It's keeping with the boxing theme of Requiem. And Requiem unquestionably is the payoff punch that follows Patterns. But Rod was very proud of The Rack, and he had every right to be proud of The Rack. If you go back and you look at that and read that script, you realize that what he's doing is he is examining the side of the person who informed because he was tortured. Now think about the relevance of that particular subject today. Yeah. He was getting into a very, very difficult subject for the mid-1950s. He also stays true to the military point of view in this. This is not an attack on the military in any way, shape, or form. He manages to walk the line of making you understand both the side of the person who was tortured and fearful and informs, and the side of the person who has to prosecute him.
One of the things that Rod did during this time was explore these kind of issues where there was no good solution.
Right.
So what becomes moral is taking the least bad solution. Mark is very familiar with another teleplay he did during that time called The Strike, which in which a major during the war has to call in an airstrike on his own men who are no longer in communication. And it's something he absolutely does not want to do because he knows these men are going to die, but he knows he has no reasonable choice in this matter. And these kind of extremely difficult moral choices were absolutely in his head during this time. And I don't know of many other writers who were dealing on that deep a level. Do you, Mark?
No. And Dan, you mentioned before about, you know, comparing him to Mark Twain. And I'm going to basically spoil part of my own introduction to the new book here. But there was a phrase that Mark Twain used to describe himself, which I think is a perfect description of Rod Serling. is a little girl in France had written Mark Twain a letter and said, you know, you're basically known as a funny person. You're basically known as this, but, you know, I sense that you are truly a moralist. And he wrote back a letter and basically saying, and he says, yes, I'm a moralist in disguise. And I thought, is there a better description of Rod Serling than that? A moralist in disguise. That fits his entire career. Behind everything, there is an intellectual grit that he's always interested in the moral underpinnings. And that's something that a lot of writers today run away from.
Yeah.
A lot of writers, like, it's almost, you know, it's not classy to have a moral, or it's not classy to overtly deal with it. Rod dealt with them, and he dealt with them head on. And I think that is one of the other reasons he's relevant today.
Rod wrote about life and death. I mean, these are the big issues. He didn't write about little tiny family dynamics or irony or anything like that. I mean, there was a lot of irony in The Twilight Zone, but it was irony put to a moral use.
I think that was part of his frustration, because he wanted to talk about these social issues and these moral issues, and the sponsors were striking everything, which is the story, as the story goes, why he launched into the Twilight Zone, because he could have, well, his quote was that an alien can say what a Democrat or a Republican can't.
Yeah.
And so he would still get these messages across, and they would slide under the radar of the sponsors, and they wouldn't know what hit them.
He also said that a writer in television need walk tiptoe and in agony, lest he offend a given cereal buyer from some state below the Mason-Dixon.
Yeah. But before I move on to Requiem for Heavy, I just want to ask two questions. Was the early television era that Serling first came up, and was that still affected by any of the remnants of McCarthyism? And what did Rod Serling think of that and people like, say, Ilya Kazan in the business? Did he have any stance on that?
I don't know that he specifically talked about Ilya Kazan, though clearly he was against naming names or anything like that. But yes, he absolutely railed against this kind of censorship. He thought censorship was appalling on television. And again, to underscore what Mark has so eloquently said, he considered public writing to be a moral value.
Mark, D, do you have any comments on that as well?
And again, it's the blacklist affected everything. It affected everything and everybody. But Rod was, by the dint of where he was and when he was, he wasn't as affected by it. When the blacklist was in its full force, he was in New York. And the New York theater scene, you know, it was not immune to the blacklist, but it was not in the thrall of it as much as Hollywood was. So he was sort of out of the firing line a little bit of that. I'm sure, and I'm guessing here, but I'm sure he was appalled by it. I'm sure he was absolutely, you know, that had he been on the firing line, he would have taken a pretty strong stance on the blacklist and the informing that went on. But, you know, and this is the lovely thing about Rod Serling. He would have understood the people who informed. He would have understood why they did it. He had a tremendous amount of human understanding and compassion. If Rod had written a drama about the blacklist, he would have condemned it and then made you feel sorry for the people who informed. That's who he was.
No, that's absolutely true. In fact, Anne mentioned that early in his life, he was blackballed by a Jewish fraternity for dating a non-Jewish girl. He wrote a teleplay called In the Presence of Mine Enemies about the Warsaw Ghetto, and he was roundly criticized by liberals and Jews, both of which he counted himself among, for writing a sympathetic Nazi character who actually goes and ultimately does the right thing. And that's the kind of nuanced, layered understanding of the human condition that Rod continually displayed.
And historically, In the Presence of Mine Enemies is interesting because it's the last Playhouse 90. It's the very last.
Oh, is that right? I didn't know that.
Yes. And the interestingly enough, the penultimate Playhouse 90 Horton Foote writes, and it's about Mark Twain. And then it's followed by In the Presence of Mine Enemies. And it's kind of symbolically the end of that era, even though the era was sort of already done. But it's 1960, the last Playhouse 90s airs in 1960. And it kind of and the Twilight Zone's already up and running at this point, but it's kind of symbolically the end of that great era of live drama. It puts the punctuation point on it.
Let me just ask one final thing before we get to Requiem. I know there was a Twilight Zone episode called "Like a Town Has Turned to Dust," and I know that was originally supposed to be a separate teleplay. It was about the Emmett Till lynching, I believe, and it got so watered down that in its 30-minute version, it became, I think, about the lynching of a Mexican back in the 1880s or something. Was that in between that period, between Patterns and Requiem, that first came and then was rejected, or was that one of the later plays after Requiem?
Well, that was the second time he had tried to deal with the horrific Emmett Till case, which was really the beginning, I think, in 1954 of the modern civil rights movement. The first was called Noon on Doomsday, and it was the same kind of thing. And Rod used to, what the networks did when they made him change the topic, the race, the location, the time, everything, he called that ritual track covering, which the networks continually tried to do. And Anna's very correct that one of his motivations for the Twilight Zone was being able to address these issues, in his case, directly.
He actually said about that script, A Town Has Turned to Dust. He said in the end, his script had turned to dust.
Yeah. So let's go to Requiem, because that's sort of considered for the live television era, sort of the Citizen Kane of of that that medium. And this is basically about a down-and-out Palooka looking to turn his life around. And I got actually the Criterion Collection that has about 7 or 8 of the classic episodes, and it has both Patterns and Requiem. And I was born in 65, so I remember it in the 1970s. Public television in New York City, where I grew up, did rerun some of those old kinescopes, I guess they would be. I know I saw a couple of other ones that had Rod Serling's name on it, but the only two that seem to have survived intact are Requiem and Patterns.
That's the comedian.
That's right. Yeah, that's on it too. Yeah, with Mickey Rooney. Yeah. So let's talk about Requiem. This is sort of his, like I said, this is considered the pinnacle, if not one of the, if it's not the Everest of the live television era, it's certainly one of the two or three highest peaks. How did that come about?
Well, Requiem was about a lot of things. And again, you have to keep in mind that in the 1950s, boxing was not a marginalized sport as it is now. It was a huge sport. And probably next to baseball, it was the most popular sport. Professional football hadn't really yet reached its ascendancy.
And it should be noted too that the boxer, they want him to become a professional wrestler, and that was also the first golden age of wrestling on television as well.
That's true, absolutely. With people like Gorgeous George, everybody remembers. And Requiem is about a lot of things, but one of the things it most primarily is about is dignity and human dignity. And the villains, the real villains of the piece, are the exploiters, the ones who try to rob ordinary people of their dignity. And the heroine is a woman who comes from a completely different social class, educational background as the hero, Mountain. And she's the one who gives Mountain McClintock his dignity. And we might also say, and Mark has written about this as well, what an incredible performance Jack Palance did in the role of Mountain McClintock. And Rod wrote that he felt that Jack was really his partner in creating this role.
As to what you just said, my dad said that he had one basic premise when he wrote Requiem, and that was that everyone can and must find their own dignity.
The Twilight Zone is imprinted on my DNA. And always will be. But Requiem for a Heavyweight is my favorite thing that your dad ever wrote. It's an amazing piece. And if you look at that, the Playhouse 90 production, everything goes right. Just everything. The direction goes right. The casting goes right. it's this moment, and when it was about to air, they thought they had a disaster on their hands. A lot of that was due to the fact that Ed Wynn had such a shaky rehearsal playing Army, the aide-de-camp in the corner, and the one who is the closest thing that Mountain has. Boy, does he pull it together. When the camera started to roll, Ed came through. But Keenan Wynn's performance, his son, as Maish, the manager, it's an amazing performance.
Absolutely.
You know? And it would completely steal the entire thing if it weren't for the fact that Jack Palance is in this.
Yeah. And Dan, you mentioned seeing the Kinescope version, and probably of all the early teleplays, this is the one that really underscores the point that we've been trying to make, that this really was a hybrid between stage and screen, because the shots are tight, they're mostly interior, they're very dark, they're very moody, and yet it has the immediacy and the electricity of live theater. So in this teleplay version of Requiem, it was eventually made into a movie with a different cast, but in the teleplay version, you really get the spark of live theater, I think.
Yeah, and that energy is missing from the movie. I like the movie, you know, and the movie has a different ending.
Yeah,
as valid an ending as the you know, it's up for grabs which ending you like, you know, better. I don't really think it much matters.
Go ahead.
Mark's right. There's an energy to the Playhouse 90 that's not in the movie. The movie almost seems lethargic compared to the Playhouse 90.
They actually did a show called The Man in the Funny Suit about the making of Requiem that my father acts in. But it goes to what you were saying, Mark, about the fear they had with Ed Wynn because he had only done comedy, and how was he going to do, you know, this serious role. And it's really quite interesting.
Yeah, it's a lovely piece.
And later, Ed Wynn appears on an extremely powerful Twilight Zone called One for the Angels, where he does a lot of his comedic shtick, but it's ultimately to a very serious purpose. And I think as much as any of them, it shows Rod's sense of cosmic justice and yet sentimentality at the same time. I don't shy away from calling Rod a sentimentalist, but his sentiments... his sentimentality was so genuine and so born of authentic emotion that you absolutely go with it. It's not treacly, it's not false, there's nothing that's not authentic about it.
I wanted to get to the adaptations of both Patterns and Requiem were made into films, and I think the Requiem film is a good film, but it does lack something. Anthony Quinn, as big a name and as many good performances as he gave in film, he doesn't measure up to Palance, I don't think. I don't think there's that, and probably the immediacy, and then I think it's Jackie Gleason and Mickey Rooney who are in place of the Wynns in the other two roles. It's good, but you know, I think I saw on YouTube Rod Serling talking about that he knew and understood television as a medium, and what you're saying about it being a hybrid between theater and film is that what works in television and the live television era so well, you know, is going to lose a little something out of the crib. Would you agree with that?
Sure, absolutely. However, I think had you just seen the movie of Requiem and there had never been a television play, you would have thought it was quite powerful. And Jackie Gleason gives an interesting performance. It's not the same. And I think Mickey Rooney gives a terrific performance.
He does. Mickey Rooney is the one really outstanding element of that movie. You believe him as a former boxer.
Yeah.
He brings really a terrific depth of performance to that movie. He's almost, and sometimes to the point that you think he's in a different movie.
And what's interesting is when you look at Mickey Rooney's career and Andy Hardy and all of the farces and spoofs he did, some of his greatest acting in the movie of Requiem for a Heavyweight, in The Comedian, in several Twilight Zone episodes, is some of the best acting Mickey Rooney ever did.
Yeah, and let's just end this segment on that note with The Comedian and some of the later plays. That's also one of the the teleplays that was in the Criterion Collection collection that I had watched some time ago. And that he really plays a real son of a bitch. He's sort of a Sid Caesar type character in that.
He's actually a Milton Berle character.
Okay.
If you go back to the actual history there.
Okay. Well, but
the writers loved Sid Caesar. They hated Milton Berle.
Okay. Well, if you can, just give a little 1 or 2 minute synopsis of the impact of that, because I think that was quite lauded too. Not quite to the extent of Requiem of Patterns, but that sort of, I guess, maybe his third most well-known work from that era, either Mark or Anna.
Well, I think one of the reasons it's not quite as well-known is because it was based on an Ernest Lehman story. It was not an original story for Rod. So, you know, he wrote this a brilliant screenplay or teleplay for this. And the performances, Mel Torme is wonderful in that production. But I think the fact that it was an adaptation, it takes a little bit of the... not the importance off of it, but, you know, you're going to look at Patterns and Requiem. Those were Rod's stories. So I think that that's one reason maybe the comedian suffers a little bit in the standing. But there's one that's right around the time, which, you know, you should talk about, which is Velvet Alley.
Yes.
Velvet Alley is an amazing piece of work. I looked back at that and looked at the performances in that. He's got two of Rod's favorite actors, Art Carney and Jack Klugman, in it. And
he's essentially looking at himself in the moral mirror, isn't he?
Yes, he is. A very brave piece of work. It's an extraordinarily, right out there piece of work. And the performances, it's for anybody who thinks that Art Carney, you know, and obviously he got, you know, a lot of props later on for Harry and Tonto and other things that he did. But, you know, what an incredible performance by Art Carney, who at the end, who digs so deep to play that role. That's another one that I think, you can't dismiss in Rod's pre-Twilight Zone work.
Okay. Well, we're going to end this segment and head over to talk about the Twilight Zone in just a moment, so please stay with us. All right, so now the thing that Rod Serling is most known for, if you Googled, it'll come up with The Twilight Zone, or just Twilight Zone, which was an anthology series on CBS from 59 to 65. And I guess by 1959, Rod Serling was getting disillusioned with corporate sponsorship and whatnot. And he gave a fairly famous interview that you can still see in its entirety now on YouTube to Mike Wallace of later 60 Minutes fame. Then I think he was just a game show host and interviewer. But it's one of the more scathing and direct interviews that you can see, because, I mean, this is 1959. He's giving the interview, and he's talking really bluntly in a way that people 25, 30 years would take 25, 30 years for people to do. If either Mark wants to just talk a little bit about that interview and how that was a part of leading into him, Rod Serling, getting the Twilight Zone off the ground.
Well, as we said before, Rod's first book was a collection of teleplays that included Patterns and Requiem for Heavyweight, called Patterns. And he wrote a rather lengthy introduction to that book. And then he added ongoing narrative and analysis on each script. It's an amazing book because of that. It's a real glimpse into the writer's mind. And one of the things you see, if you watch that Mike Wallace interview, one of the things you first think, like, well, you know, boy, he's being rough on the medium that made him. Boy, he's being, you know, is this biting the hand that has fed him all along or something like that? But then you read those introductions and you realize this is a man who had incredibly high standards. And he applied those standards to himself.
Absolutely.
When you read those introductions, he's talking about Patterns and Requiem for Heavyweight, and he's dissecting those pieces, where he went wrong, what he did right. He's brutally honest, sometimes I think too brutal on himself. in those introductions where you want to go, Rod, 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 no, no, you know, this is better than that, no. And so when he gets to that interview, this is who he was. This was not just lashing out at the medium. This was a guy who was honestly appraising where the medium was at that point and realizing he had nowhere else to go but through that signpost up ahead, the door that leads to imagination. He had to go through that door in order to remain viable and to say the things he wanted to say. And the great moment of that interview is when Mike Wallace looks at him and says, so you've given up on writing anything important now.
Yeah.
It was like, good one, Mike. Nice piece of prediction there. Because the thing that he writes that's not important from here on in is perhaps the most important thing he did with his writing career.
And there's no question that that series completely influenced our entire generation. It has become part of our soul.
Anne, go ahead.
From what I understand about that interview is that Twilight Zone was about to be launched, and he was very apprehensive that, you know, the sponsors were going to get an idea of what he was doing in terms of serious television and, again, getting these important issues across. So that I think, is why he answered that. He sort of faltered when Mike Wallace said that. You know, so you're not going to write anything serious anymore. And then he said, well, yeah, no, yes. And
Go ahead.
Let me add one other thing to that, which is, I think some of that interview has come down to people thinking, and the move into the Twilight Zone has led a lot of people to thinking, Rod sort of conveniently moved towards the fantasy world as a way of getting these messages across, which is not quite true. Rod was always interested in the fantasy world. He read deeply on writers like Edgar Allan Poe and Lovecraft and Bierce and other writers. He knew these writers. He loved these writers. He was following his passion when he moved into the Twilight Zone. This wasn't a move of convenience. This was not some kind of cynical, manipulative move. He was embracing a part of who he was. And I think that's one thing we tend to forget, is that the Rod who wrote about Requiem for a Heavyweight, who wrote about boxers, the Rod who wrote about the American corporate system and patterns, the Rod who wrote about his war influences, is that's a part of who Rod was too, was he was very deeply interested in that form of storytelling.
Absolutely, and the way he became our mentor and ideal, that's how Norman Corwin was to him. People like Norman Corwin, Arch Obler, they were his heroes.
Was the Twilight Zone in any way influenced by the slightly earlier series, One Step Beyond? Did that give Serling his idea for, I can do an anthology series, these little playlets, but not just have it be, because One Step Beyond was a very good show. It had some really good episodes, but there wasn't a deeper subtext. It was sort of like, you know, there's a monster this week, there's a ghost next week. Is it real or not? It was more sort of like Ripley's Believe It or Not, whereas the Twilight Zone had deeper undertones. But was he influenced by One Step Beyond?
He was influenced by what was going on at the time, movies like Forbidden Planet and all that. And, you know, these were fairly common, particularly the kind of B science fiction movies in those days. But the Twilight Zone sprang whole from his consciousness. I mean, this was his take. As Mark said, he'd always been interested in science fiction, particularly people like Lovecraft. But this sprang whole from his consciousness, and it just naturally evolved the way it did because of the way he felt about things.
Yeah, and, you know, people talk about Kafka-esque approaches in writing. The Twilight Zone especially became famous for sort of the Schillingian twist ending, the moral at the end. Sort of, I actually did a poem years ago called Aesop in a Modern Box about Rod Serling. He had that sort of Aesopian kind of moral at the end of each little episode. So let's.
Well, what we say, Dan, is that what O. Henry did for the short story, Serling did for the 30-minute teleplay.
Yeah. So let's talk about some of the more influential, or the ones that some of the episodes that have garnered the most fame or most recognized for certain things, and then we'll talk about some of the ones that you all think are the best. So what are, if there are four or five out of the however many 200 plus episodes that aired, which are the ones that generally that television critics and historians look back on as the most important?
Well, you're going to get the same answer from all three of us, and I remember asking Ron once, which is the one that people reacted to the most. And by far, far and away above all others, it was In the Eye of the Beholder.
Yeah, the gargoyle people.
Yes, and that I don't know that that's necessarily the best one. We all have our own favorites. But that was the one that the viewers reacted to the most, and Rod was very aware of that.
And that was very a very brutal critique of fascism.
It was a brutal critique of fascism, of everybody wanting to be the same, of the button-down society of the 1950s going into the 1960s, the man in the gray flannel suit, all of that.
Yeah. Mark D., what other episode or two can you...
You know, and this is going to sound like heresy, and it also is going to give away at least a chapter of the new book. But okay, here we go. One episode that everybody loves is the very, very first one with Burgess Meredith, and you know the
nuclear bomb falls and
the bookish, yes, right, the man who breaks his glasses at the end when he last has time to read. I really don't like that episode. It's the one that everybody goes to. It's the one that everybody, oh, the guy with the glasses, and he breaks his glasses, and it's, you know, and it's symbolically. And I always thought, you know, people who take it in the shorts in the Twilight Zone usually deserve it. This poor guy didn't deserve it. I think it's an awful message. You know,
it's only one where Rod was morally mean.
Yeah, I would say, but yet it's. I remember sitting around having dinner with David Bean Cooley, who is a TV critic and one of my best friends, and Harlan Ellison and his wife, and Charles Edward Pogue, a very fine screenwriter, and his wife. And the six of us were sitting around in Studio City having dinner, and we got to talking about The Twilight Zone, which we all adore. And everybody started going like, oh, the glasses, the broken glasses. And I said, can I say something here? And as soon as I said it, I said, they all looked at me and said, you know, you're right. You're absolutely right. I said, you know, we live in an era where, you know, reading is under fire, you know, but yet iconically it's up there with Eye of the Beholder, that if you said to somebody, what images do you remember from the Twilight Zone? And that is the power of the image, because the image of the broken glasses and the heartbreak of that moment is so strong and so powerful that it remains one of the great images from the Twilight.
Although, Mark, let me give you an alternative reading.
Interpretation.
Because that's the other great thing about the Twilight Zone. It, like Shakespeare, not quite the same as Shakespeare, but like Shakespeare, it releases many, many meanings each episode. So I would say one of the things Rod maybe have been getting at was, if you are so self-involved, if you are so insular, so uninvolved with other people, there's going to be a reckoning for that. And when all the other people who he didn't care about are destroyed, okay, well, you know, you can't relax and you can't enjoy yourself after that. Another episode, which I don't recall the name of, but it's very famous, about Bill Mumy is in it, and he's the kid with telekinetic powers.
It's a good life.
And what that's about on its surface is a kid who can do things, bad things to other people, and if you displease him, that's what he does. He'll send you out to the cornfield and things like that. But on a deeper level, what that episode you could say is really about is the consequences of bad parenting. And I think that's a kind of a profound statement.
Another episode that's probably very famous is the Damon Knight episode, To Serve Man. That's, I think, along with a handful of others, you know, the aliens come down and we're gonna rescue mankind. And that was a very big theme in like 1950s ufology. They had all of these cults springing up with saviors from Venus and whatnot, but they turned out to be a cookbook. And how about you? What are the episodes that to you are the touchstone ones, whether it's for their quality or in any personal relationship with your father?
Well, there are several. Certainly Walking Distance, you know, the ones that deal with going back in time, nostalgic things I love. So Walking Distance, A Stop at Willoughby. Interesting, the one you mentioned, Time Enough at Last. When I do presentations, that's one that people always mention. I agree with you, Mark Dewitziak, that it was brutal.
And you have to talk about In Praise of Pip and your personal connection to it.
Right. I didn't watch many of the Twilight Zones actually while my dad was still alive, and I didn't until after he died. And it was more to see my dad than to watch the actual show. And one of the first ones that I watched after he died was called In Praise of Pip with the wonderful Jack Klugman. And I realized watching this episode that my dad used a routine that he and I did. Who's your best buddy, Pop? You are Pip, you are Dad. And my dad, one of my nicknames was Pops. So this was a pretty poignant moment watching this and literally finding my dad in the Twilight Zone.
Yeah, Praise of Pip, that's, I think, the best of the four or five Klugman episodes. Everyone goes for the Gabriel's Trumpet one, which is a good episode. And that's one of the first episodes on television, I think, to deal with the Vietnam War.
It was the first.
It was? Okay. I know off the top of my head, two episodes that are probably not well known. I was just looking up online that have always stuck with me is one, because of its influence. There was an episode called The Hitchhiker, in which a fellow keeps reappearing to a woman as she's driving across country. And the reason it's so influential is, I think that was the first season, 1959. 3 years later, there's a low-budget film called Carnival of Souls made by Herc Harvey about a woman who's driving across country, and there's a guy who keeps appearing on the side of the road. It's basically a precursor to the George Romero zombie type movies, but it's interesting because everything in Carnival of Souls was an expansion upon the Hitchhiker episode, and I don't know. Let's see, did Rod write that one?
No, it was a radio show. It was a drama that had been done originally, and he had bought the story.
Lucille Fletcher, I'm seeing as the writer, the original writer. Yeah, but it's just interesting how influential that was. And the second one that has stuck with me that probably very few people know, and off the top of my head I don't know the name of, is the episode where a young girl's out riding her horse and a screaming woman comes on a horse chasing her. Stop,
Spur
stop,
of the
stop.
Moment.
Mm-hmm. Which one is
it? It's called Spur of the Moment.
Yeah.
It's a 10th season episode.
Yeah, and it basically turns out that the older woman is a version of the young girl 25, 30 years later who makes the wrong choice. And throughout the episode, you think you're rooting for her to go for the handsome guy, the Hollywood all-American good-looking guy who's going to be her Romeo, her savior. She chooses him in the end, and then you see that she made the wrong choice. And I think the thing that sticks with me is I could write several books on how I think Hollywood's ideal of this sort of juvenile Romeo and Juliet love rather than deeper forms of love has really screwed up so many people. And this is one of the few things on television or film that shows that people, you know, it's great to feel love, but sometimes you have to use your head as well. And it's so 180 degrees from how modern society, even to this day, views love. And I think that's really a very underrated episode myself.
You've actually just articulated something I'm writing about that episode, because I couldn't agree more.
Yeah.
If there was one Shakespeare I would go in and rip out, it would be Romeo and Juliet. Basically because it has propagated the myth that love, young love is never wrong.
Right.
And statistically, we can prove young love is almost always wrong.
Yeah.
The younger the marriage, the quicker the failure of the marriage. Is that enduring marriages are based on mutual sense of humor, mutual belief systems, mutual ways of viewing the world. And you know, all you have to do is to see any episode of the Oprah Winfrey Show where they have a marriage counselor on there, and the parents and the two teenagers want to run off, and the marriage counselor says, "Well, you don't know what you're up against. You don't know this." Cites statistics, everything. The parents say, "Wait, wait, wait," and then somebody in the audience stands up and says, "But they're in love."
Yeah.
And the whole audience turns as one, is like a lynch mob. Yes, they're in love. You see this in Titanic. You see this mythology being, you know, and the other one is opposites attract. And I think you're right, yeah. Rod was writing a more mature look at this as saying, you know, when you make those kinds of, the name of the episode is Spur of the Moment.
Yeah, right.
It's a play on words because she's on a horse and she's riding a horse.
Yeah. Let me just.
But it's a spur of the moment decision.
Let me just ask something, and maybe Anne knows this. Everyone knows the famous Twilight Zone theme. Do, 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 do. But the first season didn't have that theme. And I always thought that's a much scarier, it's a much more mysterious theme song. And I think the introduction, the spoken introduction by Rod Serling, is the best, most. It's the longest of the introductions. Why was that changed after the first season? Do you know, or do either the Marks know why they dropped that?
I don't know.
No,
I don't.
Oh, okay.
But let's go on.
Well, I do know they changed the opening. They changed the opening season to season, and they changed the introduction season to season.
Okay,
that's true. And in the first season, if I recall. Rod is not seen at the beginning. He's only heard.
That's right. He's not on camera until the second season, and his first real appearance on camera is in the last episode of the first season, A World of His Own, which Richard Matheson wrote, and Keenan Wynn is in playing a writer who can talk things into existence.
Oh, yeah, that's also a good one, yeah.
Dan, I think one of the most important episodes, and I know Anne agrees with me, is one completely without humor called Death's Head Revisited. And it's about a former Nazi SS officer goes back to Dachau to reminisce, essentially. And what's wonderful about it is it showed what the Twilight Zone could do at its greatest and deepest, which was create a cosmic sense of justice, which was not available in real life. In this episode, this Uber Gruppenführer is confronted by the ghosts of the prisoners he's killed, and they put him on trial, and they sentence him to permanent insanity, which is an absolutely wonderful and fitting punishment. And what's interesting about that one is almost every other episode, the closing commentary ended with, in the Twilight Zone, or the pity is that this is not just confined to the Twilight Zone. In this case, Rod knew this was important enough. He didn't end it that way. He ended it something to that. And this is true not only in the Twilight Zone, but wherever men walk God's green earth. And it is striking for its exceptionalism in that way.
Yeah.
It's hard to pick a favorite Twilight Zone episode, or, you know, because it ranges so much. But one of my favorite scripts by Rod was one, and my favorite one, because if there are two actors who are most associated with the Twilight Zone, they're Jack Klugman and Burgess Meredith, because each did four star turns during the 5-season run of the Twilight Zone. And my favorite Burgess Meredith one is not Time Enough at Last. It's an episode called The Obsolete Man.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's in a powerful, it captures a lot of Rod's themes, the value of the individual, the value of the written word, the dangers of a totalitarian society. And it's about a man that Burgess Meredith plays who identifies himself as a librarian, and the state has ruled him obsolete.
It's the most Orwellian piece, wouldn't you say, Mark?
It is. And it's one of those that it the way it's staged, it's almost staged like an avant-garde piece of theater. You could almost see it staged. You know, like a lot of Rod's pieces, you can see it actually, you can see how to stage it. You can see it, how to do this in a small, intimate theater. But it's one of my favorite pieces because it speaks to the value of the written word as well, which is something which is, you know, increasingly under fire in our culture. And I think that's an extraordinarily powerful and relevant episode. And, you know, and speaking to, you're talking about The Hitchhiker. Going back to something Mark said, that Rod wrote about life and death themes, it's interesting how many times death shows up as a character in Rod's work. One for the Angels, the one with Ed Wynn.
Yeah.
Death is a character.
Murray Hamilton, I think, isn't it?
It's Murray Hamilton.
Yeah. And then Robert Redford.
Yes, and Robert Redford, and yeah, death is a constant character throughout this, as if to say, you know, that Rod, I think, understood we're all only here for a short time. Death is here. He's, you know, he's right out of view, and he is always kind of there, and we have to deal with that. We have to interact with that, and I think, you know, and Anne can speak to this much more insightfully and eloquently than I can, but I think maybe perhaps because his own father did die so young, he understood that, you know, there's a point in your life when you understand that death is something you have to cope with. And
exactly.
We're going to get
One introduction, I don't remember which one it is, Mark, maybe you do, where he actually says, every man is put on earth condemned to die, time and method of execution unknown.
Right. And I can't remember which episode it is either, but I do remember that as you're saying it. Yeah. And I think he innately understood that. You know, and I don't even think that so much came from the war as it came from that moment when he realizes he cannot go to his own father's funeral.
And never had the necessary closure.
Right.
So it haunted him throughout his life, certainly.
I want to talk about one other episode, because I think a lot of people sometimes have thought of the Twilight Zone as being just these morality plays, but there was a lot of leeway in terms of structure. And the episode that sticks the most in my mind is the Luigi Pirandello-esque Five Characters in Search of an Exit. Excuse me, where you just have these five absurd characters. I think it's a cheerleader, maybe a clown,
a ballerina,
a major in the Air Force, a clown, a cowboy, and someone else.
I think it's a hobo.
That's right. Yeah, and for the whole show, they're stuck in a place. It looks like it's a spaceship or something. It could be something out of a forbidden planet. And up above them, it looks like they're going towards some kind of a star or something. And they're trying to get out of this this prison. And in the end, you know, it just turns out that they're dolls in a sort of Salvation Army waste bin. And the interesting thing is how deeply that gets into existential crises. We talk about Rod Serling as a moralist. You can talk about a pro or con, but existentialism is even deeper, I think. It gets to the heart of existence, and that's the episode, and there are a few others if I look through.
You're absolutely right, Dan. This is totally existentialist, as are an episode where, I believe, Inger Stevens is a robot.
On the asteroid, yeah.
There is an episode of the hour-long where George Grizzard is a robot. He goes to this Pinocchio theme over and over again of what does self-actualization mean? You know, what does it mean to be real? What does it mean to be human? And is there a distinction between being that and not being that?
You know, I would also point out that as we're talking about the Twilight Zone, one of the things that Rod deserves a lot of credit for is we know he wrote the overwhelming number of Twilight Zones, but he gathered around him a group of writers, you know, and Rod was the keeper of the Twilight Zone, if you will. He staked out the territory, he owned it, he was the proprietor, but he then had this group of writers that he brought in who understood the Twilight Zone and contributed mightily. And, you know, probably the three writers, you know, second to Rod, were Richard Matheson, Charles Beaumont, and George Clayton Johnson. And a lot of the episodes that people remember, one of those wrote some of those episodes as well. You have, and these were good friends of Rod's as
well. I mean, Nightmare at 20,000 Feet, everybody remembers.
The Gremlin on the Wing, that's right up there with the glasses and the Eye of the Beholder and those moments, the Gremlin on the Wing, the wonderful William Shatner performance, and that's, you know, Richard Matheson's The Invaders, the one with the old woman out and her home is being invaded by these little beings, and the payoff is that they're humans visiting another planet, another Richard Matheson story. So you had these contributors to the Twilight Zone who felt like they had the same freedom that Rod had found to use metaphoric storytelling to get these great points across about the human condition, They had that freedom because of Rod Serling. And each and every one of them, if you had talked to them, I got very close with Richard Matheson from 1990 on, and ended up editing three volumes of Richard's work. And we talked about Rod all the time. And the influence of that was immense. The ability to have this kind of storytelling freedom. And knowing that Rod was carrying the major load, you know, you look at how many episodes did Richard end up writing? It's about 15 or 16 episodes. You know, it's a drop in the bucket, you know. So, and Beaumont didn't, you know, compared to Rod, didn't write that much. And George Clayton Johnson, the level of his writing was very high. His, you know, he wrote Kick the Can. He wrote A Game of Pool.
He did about six or seven.
Yes. He didn't write that many, but the ones he wrote were very high quality episodes.
And Earl Hamner wrote a couple, I think.
I would not argue that The Twilight Zone was perfect for Earl Hamner. He wrote a couple of really terrific episodes. Jess Bell, for one of the few hours that really hold up very, very well. You know, he had also worked in Cincinnati. He had also worked at cut his teeth working at a station in Ohio. But you could see, you know, Earl working towards the Waltons and the things in the Homecoming and the things that really suit his writing talents. But you know, he's an important contributor to the Twilight Zone as well.
Earl Hamner worked at the radio station and had the job before my father got it. My father would introduce Earl Hamner as the man who gave him his first job.
Just a little, a minute or two about the expansion of the show to an hour and then back for the final season to a half hour. I'm looking up, it came in as a mid-season replacement in its fourth year. And I know, having watched, I think it's generally agreed that the hour format is probably the least successful of the five seasons. Would you agree?
Yeah,
I think Bob agreed to that.
Yeah, I mean, was it just a matter of fact that they tried to stretch a half-hour material out, or was it just they were running out of steam by season four?
That was part of it, and Rod also didn't feel that the twist endings worked as well after you built it up for that long a period.
Uh-huh. And I think it's a matter of structure. You know, water finds its own level, storytelling finds its own length. The Twilight Zone was naturally a half-hour show. That's what the vibe they wrote for. That was the whole. And so you look at these hours, not to say there are not hours that don't hold up. Take a look on Thursday, We Leave for Home, and that Tour de Force James Whitmore performance in the middle of that. There are hours that hold up very, very well. Jess Bell is an hour that holds up extremely well. That justify the hours seem padded.
Yeah.
And that often happens with shows which play outside of their comfort zone. And I think The Twilight Zone spent 3 years telling half-hour stories. And then all of a sudden they said, okay, shift. And it's like, you know, okay, you train for the 50-yard dash, and then all of a sudden they say, okay, now let's double the length and run that length. Well, that's different training. You have to train differently for that. You have
I told a funny story that really speaks to this, how television puts its own special demands, not exactly related to what Mark was saying. But he said, all right, you come in and you pitch a story about a prince in Denmark whose father has just died. His wife has... he said his wife has just married the uncle who he doesn't like, who he suspects of murder. He's being forced away from his girlfriend, who is the daughter of the prime minister, and on and on and on. And he says, after he describes Hamlet, as it is, and he said, okay, now give me 26 weeks of that.
Right. Yeah. And that's what television does. The Twilight Zone's great advantage was that it could reinvent the wheel every week.
Right.
You know, television likes recurring characters. And by the way, what this is also speaks to the success of The Twilight Zone is television is a character-driven medium. And
yes,
it loves, you know, the old saying about television is familiarity breeds content. That the audience likes formula that gets repeated week after week. And they become comfortable with the characters going through the same track every week. The Twilight Zone did not have recurring characters, but it did. It had Rod Serling.
That's right.
It did have a recurring character. It had somebody that people felt they knew, even though, as Anne will tell you, Rod didn't really talk like that at home. He wasn't the submitted for your approval guy. That wasn't the guy who, off camera, but people felt like they knew him, and they felt invested in that relationship. So that's the important thing. When you sort of say, like, well, what did the Twilight Zone have that other anthologies didn't have? On so many levels, that answer comes back to it had Rod Serling. It had Rod Serling behind the camera as a producer. It had Rod Serling as its principal writer. And it had Rod Serling as the person making the connection with the audience. And, you know, the only other anthology show that sort of had that was Alfred Hitchcock, was the fact that Hitchcock himself introduced the stories and people look forward to the playful things that he used to do around it. And people felt that they knew Hitchcock the way they knew Serling. So that's it, you know, that's something you can't underestimate, the fact that when Rod went on camera, it not only took him up several levels as a celebrity and as a writer, because let's face it, as we were saying before, how many people recognize writers? You know, can the average American pick, you know, Herman Melville out of a lineup? Do they have any shot at it? You know, well, no, you know, there's the, but if you showed them iconically a picture of Mark Twain and said, who is this? They'd have a pretty decent shot at saying, well, even if they've never read Mark Twain, saying it's Mark Twain, you know. And even people who maybe have never even seen an episode of The Twilight Zone will probably say, that's Rod Serling. You know, that's amazing. You can't, don't skip by that real fast. Stop and think about the importance of that. You know, even really well-known writers like Norman Mailer, if you stood in the middle of any mall in America and stopped the first 10 people and said, who is this? Most people probably wouldn't get it's Mailer. And Mailer was one of the most recognized writers.
Absolutely true.
So, but Rod Serling, they've got a really good shot at recognizing who Rod Serling is.
That's amazing. Let me go back, talk a little bit about some of the contributors and how they connected with Serling, because you mentioned Earl Hamner had worked in Cincinnati, and this is for any of the three of you. Were most of the directors, most of the writers, the co-collaborators on The Twilight Zone, were these people that Serling had worked with beforehand, or were they people just from the network?
Mark, that's yours.
In the case of Matheson and Beaumont, no. The Twilight Zone was the connection. Rod needed writers who could write and the fantasy world. He needed people who were specialists in a way. And so Matheson and Beaumont, who were best friends, by the way, Richard and Chuck had been best friends throughout the 50s. They were sort of stalking horses for each other. One would get a short story published, the other would get a short story published. One would get a novel published, the other would get a novel published. Their families were very close. So the fact that these two writers became the first two principal writers after Rod was highly significant. So they were specialists. They had not written much for live television. They had been writing basically for the magazines, like Amazing Stories and Fantastic Stories and things like that, and publishing books. So when they showed up, and Richard had already written I Am Legend, which is, you know, you talk about leading to George Romero and The Walking Dead. I Am Legend is the direct link.
Yeah.
And The Shrinking Man, I think, he'd already written at that point.
He had written Shrinking Man and I Am Legend. So, you know, when he shows up in 1959, you know, he's checking in as one of the principal fantasy writers on the scene at that moment.
But Dan, you also brought up something very important, which is that when you said, who are the directors? Well, we can tell you who the directors are, but it's not that important. And the reason it's not that important is, unlike the movies, where you can tell who directed every film, and you probably can't tell many of the writers, television was and is to this day a writer's medium. It's the writer who's important. The showrunner is never a director, it's always a writer. And The Twilight Zone was a perfect example of this. Rod had very little interest in the directing and the show elements and the producing, even though he was listed as the executive producer. This was a writer's medium, and this is where writers shine.
Yeah. Now I want to just end up this segment, and then in the next segment we'll talk a bit more about the post Twilight Zone. We'll talk some about Anne's book. But I did want to end with a little trivia question, and this is for people. I was looking at some of the directors that had directed Twilight Zone, and there are people like Richard Donner, Don Siegel, Joseph Newman, Jacques Tenure. But I actually met one of the Twilight Zone directors when I was a child. When I was 5 years old, and I want to throw this out to see if you can guess who it is. And I, for those people listening, I did not talk about this beforehand with any of the three experts here. But I was 5 years old. I grew up on the Brooklyn-Queens border, not too far from where Spike Lee directed Do the Right Thing. In those days, it was a very rundown area. It were a lot of sex shops, pornography, a lot of mafia influence. If you ever saw Goodfellas, the character played by Ray Liotta, I was one of those types of kids there. And one of the days, I was bringing some food for some guy who sent me down to the deli, and you'd get 50 cents to do the little errand. And I came back, and they were shooting what was then known as a stag film. This was the pre-Deep Throat days. And I was introduced to the guy who's directing this stag or blue film. And he had a lot of memorabilia around, photographs of big stars. One of them was, I'll tell you who they were. I wanted to know, the reason I asked if Rod Serling knew anything about people's background, because one of the directors of The Twilight Zone was in the 1950s under a pseudonym, a very well-known stag or blue film director. And I don't know if Rod Serling knew this, but do any of you have any idea of which director I'm talking about?
I don't.
No? Okay, I'll give you an example. He had photos of him with people he'd worked with, like Jim Brown, David Janssen, who was then a huge star coming off The Fugitive. His name was Buzz Kulik, and I didn't know anything about that beforehand, but he had apparently been doing them for 15, 20 years beforehand, and this was, I guess, and I looked up in preparation for the show, apparently he had a few flops in the late 60s with big films. And then about a year later, he directed Brian's Song, which is one of the seminal, mm-hmm. television films of the early 70s about the death of an NFL player. And
Brian Piccolo.
Yeah, Brian Piccolo, right. I think that was maybe the thing that made Billy Dee Williams a star.
It was.
Yeah. And I was just wondering, because anyone listening to this, it's one of those little bits of trivia that I didn't know the name until years later, and I'm thinking, I remember that's the guy from The Fugitive. And when I looked it up and I saw the name, this was a couple of years ago, I said, that's the guy who was, no, and he didn't go, I won't out his name in the business. I don't know if films from that era even survive, but it was just interesting. But
Rod would have loved that, I think. The one thing... we haven't talked about, he had an incredible sense of humor. He was personally, he was a very funny man.
Yeah.
And I get the feeling he was not judgmental in that way.
Yeah.
From what the Rod I sense, he would have been judgmental of people who hurt other people.
Yeah. Exactly.
He would have been judgmental of
people who... Aunt has a photograph of him with a lampshade over his head. Really?
Well, let's end this segment. Like I said, when we get back, I want to talk about the post-Twilight Zone until Rod Serling's death. And we'll also talk about Anne's book and also the Rod Serling books. And we'll do that in a moment. All right. Well, I want to mix it up a little bit. Instead of just going on with the Serling post-Twilight Zone, I want to just backtrack or sidestep a little bit and want to talk a little bit first about Anne Serling's book about her father, give her a while to just talk about some of the anecdotes behind the book, the making of the book, and her life with her father, and then also talk about Rod Serling's book. So Anne, you wrote the book, or it was published in 2013. How long had you been writing the book about your father?
It took about 6 or 7 years to write that book. And there were really three reasons that I wrote it. One was to navigate that whole minefield of grief and to find a way to manage it. I wanted to know more about my dad's professional life. And there had been some fallacious things written about my father that described a man that was not remotely familiar to me or any of his friends. And so I thought it was an opportunity to set the record straight.
Without getting into libel, but can you give like at least just one example of something that was out there in the media that was distorted?
Well, one of my dad's, his novella, Season to Be Wary, was out with Random House. And there was some, one of the writers said that my father was furious. Actually, it was with Little Brown. And my father, is this correct, Mark?
Yes.
And my father, it was said that my father.
He said that, the writer said that your father was furious at Random House for not publicizing it. And to which I said, why should Random House publicize a Little Brown book?
Exactly. And that was just one example. You know, and they also described him as this tortured, dark soul. And that was not anyone that my father was. Any description that would have been accurate.
That's true.
Does the book start from your early childhood and then trace through your father's death? And does it go post your father's death into his legacy as well?
Well, in the beginning, I talk a lot about my dad's childhood and when he was going off to war and a box of letters that I found that he had written before he was sent to training camp. Letters to his parents, letters from his parents, letters to friends. And this was actually a pretty poignant, powerful time of writing the book to read these letters. My dad was only 19 when he went off to war, and that's the age that my son was when I was writing it. So it had an impact on me to see how young my dad was and any person that goes off to war. And then I talk about growing up with my dad, essentially.
I know what you're talking about. I remember years ago, my mom and I opened up my dad's old locker or trunk when he was in the CC camps during the Great Depression, and we found a lot of old letters from girls in Idaho calling him killer and sweetie, and my mom was like, I don't know who these girls were. But it was pre-marriage, of course. But how long is the book, and do we get mostly personal anecdotes as well? I mean, can you give, like, say, an anecdote from the book, you know, whether from your childhood between your mother and father, if you guys took a trip someplace, what's one of the more standout, more memorable incidents from the book that you describe?
Oh, boy. I talk about how my dad was a practical joker, and I think Mark Olshaker, you commented on, or Mark DeWitziak, I can't remember which one of you commented about my dad would appear in lampshades and things like that. Again, this speaks to who he was as a person, you know, not this professional side. My dad also did a hell of an imitation of a gorilla and would frequently, you know, do this monkey act. And it was really quite hilarious. My father was funny, brilliantly, brilliantly funny. And my friends who might be wary about meeting him for the first time, thinking, you know, this is the Twilight Zone guy, would instantly feel comfortable when they met him. He just had the capacity to sort of make people feel comfortable and important. And
Dan, I can tell you this book is the best book that's ever been written about Rod. It's deeply personal and very meaningful. And I'll tell you something that Dan probably won't tell you, which is that a number of readers, more than a few, have come to her, written to her, and said that this book helped them deal with their own grief and their own sense of family. So I can't think of a better tribute.
Yeah, actually, Mark, thank you for saying that, because I did a reading before the book was done at the Paley Center, and a woman came up to me afterwards and said that her father had a terminal illness, and that after hearing me read, she knew she'd be okay. And this was overwhelming to me, and what a gift this was to know that in some way my words had meant something to her and had helped in some way. And I've heard that from a lot of people that dealing with grief, that it has helped them. And this has just, you know, been so gratifying and so humbling to know that it's helped people in some way.
Let's talk about a little bit about your relationship with your father through the years, because your father would have died when you were in your early 20s or so. It's probably been, it's been 40 years since. Were you and your father... was he spend more time at home after the Twilight Zone and between Night Gallery? Were those few years the most memorable for you? Did you like? I know I read that he had gone on the lecture circuit for a while. Did you ever travel with him when you were younger?
To your first question, I had just turned 20 3 weeks before my dad died. I do remember traveling with him once when he went to see his agent. I can't remember, in Chicago, I think that was. I know in the Mike Wallace interview, he talks about how his work day was 12 hours a day or something. But I never felt that my dad wasn't accessible or available, despite, you know, long work days. He had an office in the backyard. And so although we weren't supposed to bother him when he was working, we always knew that, you know, in an emergency, we could go knock on the door. And
in the intervening years between your father's death and your writing this book, and also I assume you're involved in the Rod Serling books, which we'll talk about in a moment, were you involved in any of your father's other projects? That were you like the executive of his estate? Because I know in the 1970s that the Twilight Zone magazine was big. In fact, I remember reading a Stephen King story, and I'm not a big Stephen King fan, but a friend told me that it was a Stephen King story in like 77 or 78 in the Twilight Zone magazine about a guy who would fall asleep and then he would live, it was maybe transporting to another planet, and they would put you in a deep sleep, and if you woke up during the sleep, you would experience all of time then, and you'd come out on the other side a wizened old man. And that was one of the stories that always stuck with me. So did you have any hand through the years in any of the projects, like the later Twilight Zone series, as his daughter or executor?
No, my mother was involved with the magazine, and in terms of the two Twilight Zone shows that had a pretty short-lived, I think, existence, I had no say in that.
Okay.
But let's add that some of your earliest professional writing were adaptations of some of your dad's stories.
Right. I actually novelized One for the Angels and The Changing of the Guard. Of course, my dad did the hard work. All I had to do was flesh it out. But that was a very rewarding experience and fun to do.
Let me contradict her. There was a lot that went into it, and it showed how beautiful Anne's writing is. Adaptation is not easy.
Well, you know, if I could say something that Anne will not say about her own book, let me brag a little bit about the book, because it is on two levels. It is about her dad, but it is about her own journey dealing with grief, and it's a profound experience. And but there's something else about the book on a personal level. I'm the one person on your panel, Dan, who did not meet Rod Serling. I'm the one person here who did not have that privilege. And I've read throughout my life everything that's ever been written about Rod, every interview he ever gave. I've seen practically every scrap of footage of him on anything from, you know, commercials and quiz shows to the Twilight Zone Night Gallery. And reading Anne's book was the very first I was meeting the real Rod Serling. This is the only way you're going to meet him. This is the only way you're going to have that honor and that privilege, is to read. And it's a fully developed, real human being who comes across in this book. And I couldn't find him anywhere else.
And I,
Twilight Zone, I couldn't find him in the Twilight Zone. I couldn't find him in all of these other things, but I did find him in Anne's book.
I certainly recognized the man I knew in Anne's book.
And I would assume that, Anne, when you were saying that you had nothing to do with the two TV revivals, you also had nothing to do with the film that was made?
No.
Okay. So let's move on and talk about RodSerlingBooks.com. How did that come about? Let's, you know, talk about its provenance and what you're hoping to do, and what have been any books released so far. How did that come about, Anne? Was that you who initiated it?
Well, it's something my husband and I had talked about, and we, you know, with the publishing world collapsing as we know it, we wanted to provide a platform for established writers and new writers, and we thought this would certainly be something that my dad would champion. So we've now published 8 books that were out of print, Patterns, Requiem, a couple of Twilight Zone books. My dad novelized 19 of the Twilight Zones, Night Gallery stories that he novelized. We've also put those out. And Season to Be Wary, which was the novella that my dad did, where actually 2 of those episodes became Night Galleries.
And they have, and they all have introductions by some very distinguished and insightful writers.
Right. Like Mark Olshaker and Mark Witziak.
And Anne Sirleaf.
And, yeah.
I'm looking, it says on the website, the Sirleaf genre, and it's very Twilight Zone-ish. And then I also see content guidelines like against pornography, offensive content, cursing, etc. I'm just wondering, do you think that might be limiting? Because I had mentioned like a film like Goodfellas, and that's a film that has a lot of cursing and whatnot, but you can't really deny it's a work of art. Do you think that there might, you might have too strict the guidelines, you know?
Well, we're certainly open to cursing. And I also wanted to add that we also just printed an anthology with 11 writers, and that's just come out. I don't think the restrictions that you've mentioned have, I don't think it's been problematic in any way.
No. How about, because it seemed that, you know, there's the term I would use, probably there's didactic, it looks like it's a didactic, and that's not, I don't mean that in a pernicious sense, but are you looking for all the same? I mean, ideally, let's say if a young writer comes along, what are you actually like looking for? Are you looking for something that's definitely Sirleaf-esque, or if it's something that just approaches the same topics, even though it might be in 180 degrees?
Well, Mark DeWitziak, you can speak to this too, that initially we wanted something very Sirleaf-esque, and one of our writers had submitted something that really wasn't, but it was so damn good that we decided, is this something my dad would have liked? And then that became the new criteria for what we would publish.
So that's WWRD, what would Rod do?
Yeah, right.
I think this goes back to something we talked about before. What is Sirleaf-esque? Well, it's a very wide thing, isn't it? If you limit it and say, you say, this is Sirleaf-esque, and you think, well, this is the Twilight Zone. What was the Twilight Zone? You know, it's not quite fantasy, but it is. It's not quite science fiction, but it embraces it. It's not horror, but it touches on it. And that's just within genre. But then you look at all of the live TV dramas they did, the post-work, all the themes we've touched on, the boxing, you know, his incredible interest in writing and writers. When you come right down to it, what is Sirleaf-esque is a very wide interpretation, and should be. So when we say
what connects it all is a moral sensibility.
That's right. That's right. So we, you know, are we going to pursue projects with Rod Sirleaf books which are distinctly reminiscent of the Twilight Zone? Yeah, we probably will. But will we exclude something which might be Patterns-like or Requiem-like? No, we're not. If it's a good piece of writing and it's and it fits the moral sense of what, you know, and also the sense of social responsibility,
right,
that, you know, Rod had. So we see this as a very, not restrictive, but a very open interpretation of what would Rod do. Well, look at the amount of things that Rod did do, as Mark was saying, in that those 20 years. Look at the sheer volume of work and variety of work. All of it is Sirleaf-esque in one way or another. So
what we're looking for is imagination and a sense of the world.
Mm-hmm. And I just want to add that both Marks are on our board of directors, as are Scott Skelton and Jim Benson, who did the Night Gallery book.
Well, let me take the idea of Sirleaf-esque and let's talk about some of the post-Twilight Zone work. But let me just detour for a second. I've had an argument, and we talk about artists and what defines them and whatnot. And over the years, when I was a kid growing up, I used to watch a lot of the talk shows. I mentioned in the break some of the, I want to do a show on classic talk show hosts. And one of the frequent guests was Orson Welles. And Orson Welles about in 1949 had starred in a film called The Third Man, directed by Carol Reed. And it's considered one of the great film noirs and one of the great films of all time. And there's always been a controversy because Welles had claimed throughout the 60s and 70s on these shows that he had a greater hand directing-wise than was credited for. And if you look at Carol Reed's work, Third Man is very much out of his general line of work. And, you know, and that's the famous one with them on the Ferris wheel and looking down at the people like their ants. And I've always argued that a great artist has such a distinct stamp on things that there's no way that I can believe that this is all Carol Reed. Welles, I mean, I could get into many of the things, but they're so Wellesian. And in a similar way, if we're talking Serling-esque, I want to talk about The Planet of the Apes, because I've always read that, you know, Rod Serling wrote the first draft and that was it, and they threw out 99% of it, and they only kept basically the famous ending with the Statue of Liberty. However, I've always thought, when I go through that film, and just going through chronologically, just off the top of my head, there are so many images that are so Serling-esque or Serlingian, however you want to say it, that I have to feel, and let me just finish my little preamble here. You know, in the opening of that film, they find out that the woman that they've been traveling with when they crashed the three men died centuries ago because a pebble hit her container tube or whatnot. So right away we have, this is a testosteronic movie. There's no women that are, you know, even though the one woman, Nova, is mute. Then you have the X's that mark the forbidden zone that are very reminiscent of what you saw in World War II around Nazi death camps. You have the first image of the general ape coming through the corn stalks, and it's like a giant phallic symbol rising up out of Mother Earth. You have the famous, you know, monkey see, monkey do, don't hear no evil, see no evil, speak no evil, human see, human do. And, you know, to me, these are all, and then there's the get your filthy paws off me, you damn dirty ape. To me, these seem so Rod Serling-esque that I have to believe, just as a fan and someone who watched it, that he had more input than he's credited for. Am I crazy or right, Anne?
Dan, I think you just said it.
Yeah.
I want to say, from what I understand, my dad, he was the initial writer brought on board, but his script turned out to be too expensive to make, and that's when they brought in Michael Wilson, I think, is the second writer was. Mark Olshaker, you were so helpful to me when I was writing my book and learning more about the professional side of my dad, and I think I may have learned that from you, actually.
Yeah, no, that's true. So, yeah, a lot of it was toned down, if you will, and changed, but you're absolutely right, Dan. I mean, the essential Rod is there in the script, and it wouldn't have been had he not been involved with the project.
And I
agree. I absolutely agree. There are lines throughout, you know, because not only visual, Dan, you're talking about visual, but the ear picks up things that are so Serling-esque, if you will. And sometimes they're even throwaway lines. There's a point where Charlton Heston is trying to escape and somebody's giving a speech in the background and he's and he never met an ape he didn't like. And I thought, that's Rod. There's no way that's not Rod. You know. So yeah, you're right. There you watch that movie and there are elements all the way through.
The museum with stuffed humans. I mean that goes back to running a numerous Twilight Zone episodes where you'll see humans as playthings for other creatures. I mean, whether it's apes or aliens, you know, and the thing is, for even putting aside being a large studio, it's hard to imagine. I mean, that's one of the most blistering political films of all time. I mean, it really is. It touches on race. As I said, there's no women. It touches on religion, the fundamentalism of Dr. Zaius and denying the truth of the rise of the Planet of the Apes. I mean, that film to me is alongside with The Third Man. I mean, as Wellesian as The Third Man is, Planet of the Apes is Serlingian. And you know, I I've argued this with people, and they say, oh, well, no, it says so here or there. I say, I don't give a damn. I mean, I'm an artist. I write. I know what I'm seeing, and I know that you don't get the same cadences. You don't get the same observations. I mean, like you mentioned, you could take an Oscar Wilde or a Mark Twain script, and you can have 10 script doctors come in. It's the essential, the baseline there, the bottom, the undergirding is Serling.
This also goes back to Eye of the Beholder, where what's beautiful and what's ugly.
Yeah.
Yeah, and there's also certain scenes, as you're saying, Dan, as a writer, you can analyze Planet of the Apes, and there are certain dialogue exchanges which are 100% Rod's cadences in writing. The point where, you know, Heston looks at Dr. Zaius and says, I scare you. I've scared you right from the beginning. Yeah. And it's right. I think that's a Rod piece of dialogue.
The little doll that squeals and it falls to the floor. I mean, that's right out of the Burgess Meredith kind of episode, the dropping of something. I mean, it's, yeah.
When he says to him afterwards, you know, we were here first. Yeah. We were here. And, you know, Zaya says, so why aren't you still here? You know, it's a moment that's very much right out of the Twilight Zone, if you will. So yeah. I agree. I think that film has Rod's fingerprints all over it.
And if you look at the other Planet of the Apes films, the subsequent ones in the initial series, you look at the 98 or no 01 one and the current one. I've only seen clips of the current one, but I've seen enough big scenes and the 01 one. That first film is just so good. Mm-hmm. You know.
But the intellectual subtext is gone from those other films.
Right.
You know.
Yeah.
What's the missing ingredient?
Right. And before we hit Night Gallery, let's talk, what were there any other film scripts or screenplays that Rod had been working on at that time that got produced or didn't get produced, and why not anyone?
7 Days in May is certainly an important film.
Yeah. That's the Cuban Missile Crisis? No.
It was a military plot to overthrow the United States. And
Frederick March plays the president, and Burt Lancaster plays a general who is planning a coup d'etat, and Kirk Douglas plays his aide who realizes it's his role to try to get a man caught in the middle of a moral dilemma, a classic Rod Serling story, if you will, although it's based on a novel. But here is Kirk Douglas in the middle of all this, trying to stay true to the man who was his mentor and his hero in many ways, and his country. It's a very powerful piece, and I think 7 Days in May comes closest to blowing up the canard that Rod couldn't write a screenplay.
And also pick up on what Mark just said. It's also in a military setting, and to go back to his experience in World War II, it's also about when do you not follow orders.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Yeah. It's a very tightly written piece.
Before we get to Night Gallery, let me just ask one final thing. I know Anne had mentioned novelizing some of her father's stuff, and I guess maybe some other people have. I remember reading somewhere, and I don't know if it was in Mark Zickory's book or something years ago, that one of the sort of things that haunted Rod Serling was that because he felt that he had been birthed in the medium of television, he felt a fear of failure to try to write a great American novel along the lines of Mailer. Is there any truth to that?
No, there's no truth to that. This would have been a natural evolution for him. He had begun in 1967 with The Season to Be Weary to try longer form fiction, and he was quite good at it. I went to visit him. It was my senior year in college, so this would have been probably December of January of 1970. Or January 1971, and he showed me a manuscript he had already written and was polishing based on his teleplay, A Storm in Summer. Now, I don't know whatever happened to that, but I distinctly remember seeing it, and he told me he was working on another novel. Now, interestingly enough, Anne was away at school at that point, and let me turn off the phone here. Anne was away at school at that point, and he had written her a letter about 3 weeks after my visit, and talked about a novel he was working on that he thought she would like. And neither Anne nor I really know what that novel was or what became of it. But if he had lived, there's no question in my mind he would have become a novelist and a good one.
I agree with that.
So let's talk a bit about Night Gallery. When did that come out? And I know that's sort of been, I vaguely remember that as a child, and I probably saw some, I think in the late 70s, they ran it late night with like Barnaby Jones and Mannix Repeats as a kid. I remember seeing some of them. How did Night Gallery come about, and what was the overall fate critically of it?
The pilot of Night Gallery was actually based on some of the short stories, the novellas, from The Season to Be Wary, one of which was directed by a young guy who just come on the Universal lot named Steven Spielberg. And Mark, I think you know what happened to him. What was it?
Yeah, he did something or other. I guess we lost track of it. But yes, and the it was done as a TV movie by NBC and aired under the title Night Gallery. Rod wrote a third story. There was a third story in the Season to Be Wary that they decided not to use. So he wrote one more story.
And it was racially oriented, which was very interesting. They, even in 1971 or whatever it was, they were still afraid of this concept on television.
Right. So this got NBC interested in perhaps doing a horror anthology. And it started out at that point, NBC had these wheels. The most famous was their mystery wheel that would alternate Columbo with McCloud, with Macmillan and Wife, and
that's
there was
right,
always a fourth element
that
they couldn't fill. So they decided they had a concept they called 3-in-1. And Night Gallery rotated with a couple other elements for its first year, and then was a weekly series for a second season, and then limped into a third season, and it was canceled. Night Gallery is... I love Night Gallery. Let me first, get this out there. I'm a huge Night Gallery fan. Night Gallery came along at a time when there was not... We take horror for granted today, because horror is everywhere. You'll turn around, there's The Walking Dead, and then you turn around, and there's, Twilight, and there's, it's everywhere you turn. Back then, there was very little that was done in the horror field. There was Hammer horror films would come along every once in a while. There was Dark Shadows on daytime television. But, if you were a horror fan, when anything came along, you jumped on it. And all of a sudden, there was this thing called Night Gallery, and Rod Serling was fronting it. And I was in junior high school when it started. And I was, I'm like, this is for me. They made a series for me. Now it is not the iconic series that The Twilight Zone is, largely because Rod had worked so hard on The Twilight Zone. That was such an incredibly intense experience to be the producer, the lead writer, be on camera, that he said, I'm not going to do that again. So, I'll be your on-camera host and I'll be a contributor, all right, but I won't produce it. I don't know whether he'd go back and he would take that one back or not, because
yes, he told me so. He became very frustrated that when he did want to step in and exert some editorial control, he was totally rejected from it. And in fact, when he was doing Twilight Zone, he used to hang around the MGM studios all the time. I remember by the time he was doing Night Gallery, he would drive over to Universal, do his bits, and leave immediately and go back home.
So
I remember Jack Laird's name spoken throughout the house, because my father would say his name through gritted teeth. He was
Jack Laird's the producer,
right? Mm-hmm. Because he had no creative control, and it became a show that made comment, my dad said, on nothing. It became sort of a cheap horror vignettes. But my dad, there were also some excellent shows on Night Gallery. One being, they're tearing down Tim Riley's bar, which is very much like the Twilight Zone episode Walking Distance, which either was nominated for an Emmy or it won an Emmy, Tim Riley's Bar. But it's a lovely, lovely script.
Yeah, and there was another, what's the other one that's really important?
The Messiah's Due on Mott Street is probably
the one. The Messiah of Mott Street, again, a beautiful, beautiful piece.
But, you know, and that's it. Night Gallery, it would be terrible not to be. Jack Laird and Rod's instincts were diametrically opposed.
Right.
Jack Laird loved these stupid little vignettes, these blackout sketches, these comedic things which cheapen the show. But at the same time, some excellent writers worked on Night Gallery. Richard Matheson contributed a couple of stories to Night Gallery.
It's interesting that Mark mentions these blackouts because one of the creative concepts that kind of went awry with Night Gallery was, unlike the Twilight Zone, unlike anything else that had been done on television, each story was supposed to have its own natural length. If it was a 5-minute story, fine. If it was a half hour story, fine. So what Jack Laird ended up doing was essentially filler, wouldn't you say, Mark, where he would have these blackout sketches with people like Victor Buono, were just silly and stupid.
Yeah, like a stupid joke on Phantom of the Opera or Dracula or something like that. And in the middle of this, you had some really first-rate storytelling that was done. So Night Gallery is a failed series by any counts, but I would hate for not to have it.
Yeah.
Not to mention the fact that I think Rod's introduction work on Night Gallery is wonderful. He has, if anything, he's loosened up a little bit. He's smiling a little bit more. He almost, maybe because he wasn't so deeply involved, and I realize it wasn't a good experience, but he's masking it. This shows you how good an actor Rod was. He's masking it awfully well in those introductions. And there are several episodes of Night Gallery that linger with me, and several of them are Rod's script. He wrote one called Soul Survivor.
Yes.
And Soul Survivor is a wonderful. I often joke that Rod wrote the metaphor for my life, and it is Soul Survivor because I keep going from one doomed newspaper to another. I am that guy in that episode who gets set adrift in the Titanic and gets picked up by the Lusitania. You know, I said, "Hey, it's right there." You know, but I can remember that episode watching it the moment it aired the first time. So there are some wonderful episodes. And several of them Rod wrote. And he had to compromise an awful lot. It was very frustrating for him to compromise. It was very frustrating for him to know that this series could have been so much more and so much better. But I would hate not to have Night Gallery. You know, it's still a series which, it's a series of moments. Let's put it that way. It's a series of wonderful moments.
I was just looking online, the Tim Riley episode you mentioned had the old game show host Bert Convy. Another one had Ron Howard's younger brother Clint Howard in it.
The boy who could predict earthquakes is a wonderful episode.
I see that... Sue Lyon from Lolita. I told you last week I was doing a Kubrick show, so she was in that. And the thing I remember about the show is at the time, I think there were all three networks, ABC, NBC, and CBS. There was a fad for about 2 or 3 years. I think it was after Rowan and Martin's Laugh-In became big of this blackout sketch thing. There was an ABC show called Love American Style. And I always thought Night Gallery was sort of a cross between Twilight Zone and Love American Style. Because you mentioned...
Not that description.
Well, yeah. I think because I remember there were a lot of silly things. The problem was the little funny things. They didn't have an Artie Johnson or a Ruth Buzzy who they could... just say, okay, we need 3 minutes, improvise something. You mentioned Victor Buono kind of thing. They always seem kind of stiff and awkward, those little filler inserts.
And became a show that was not what my dad's intention was.
Let's talk then about the last few years of your father's life. Between his death and I believe he died, I rewatched American, I think it's American Masters or American Experience, 90-minute show from, I guess it's the late 90s or so, or early O's, on your father. And did he die on the operating table or did he die of a heart attack?
The show that you're talking about is called Submitted for Your Approval.
Yeah.
And it does begin with the surgery, which always bothered me. But my dad had three heart attacks. And the decision was then to have open heart surgery, which of course in 1975 was a brand new surgery.
Yeah.
Today it would have been a very, very different outcome. My understanding is they finished the surgery, and when they closed him up, my dad had another heart attack and died 3 days later.
Oh, okay. Was there anything in the works at his death? Was he planning any other series? You mentioned Mark Olshak. You mentioned a novel that never came to fruition. Do any of you know, did he have anything, any deals going on for movies or screenplays or anything?
He was working constantly.
Rod was what I you know, there are certain writers who love the canard about, you know, well, I hate writing, but I love having written. Well, you know, the heck with you. You know, it's about hard work. That's what it is. And I think Rod understood that. And Rod was one of those writers. Tennessee Williams was a compulsive writer. He was constantly writing. You know, Mark Twain was a compulsive writer. Rod was a compulsive writer. He was somebody who was, if he wasn't writing, he was thinking about the writing process. He was thinking about the next story. He was thinking about the next, you know. I picture Rod's brain as just constantly firing, you know, and Ann can speak to this better than anybody, but you can sense this when you study the man's work. This is a guy who probably would have never, ever, ever stopped. He had a boxer's mentality. Requiem for a Heavyweight, I know I've used this phrase before, but Rod understood that you are on this planet for only a certain amount of time. And no matter how many years you get, it's a short amount of time. And you do not stop swinging until the man counts 10.
Yeah, I agree with that.
And he understood that, and I think that was how he went through his entire life.
I once asked him, I said, does the writing ever get easier? And he said, no, but you become less afraid of it.
Mm-hmm. Well, lovely way to put it.
Well, let's end this segment before we do our final closing segment. Let me just ask about Rod Serling in the 21st century. Obviously, with the Rod Serling books, you guys are looking to propagate his name and legacy. In the 40 years since his death, let's talk about the last 40 years critically. The way books that have been read. You mentioned Scott Mark Zickory had written a book, I believe, was. Mark Scott Zickory, I'm not sure. And what do you think going forward in this century? Let's talk a little bit about legacy. Anyone want to, either the Marks, do you want to talk about where we are now?
Well, I'll just say that Rod was probably the worst evaluator of his own legacy. He would be shocked to, in the last interview he did, and he also said this to me personally, he said, 100 years from now, if his name is just remembered and the term writer is put next to it, that would be enough for him. I think he would be absolutely shocked to know how tremendous his impact has been, how many books, how many articles, how many shows have been done based on that, and Ann has participated in this every year in his hometown of Binghamton, New York, the fifth graders every spring, to an entire unit on morality and society based on Twilight Zone episodes. I've been privileged to speak before them. Ann does it every year. I think he would be absolutely shocked. And the proof of that is it's often been said in the Rod Serling community that I was the only one who he ever authorized to write his biography. That's a little bit of a strain. What happened was I was, as a young man, already a professional writer, I asked him if he would cooperate with me on writing a book about him. And he said he would absolutely cooperate and do whatever I wanted, but he had to warn me that he thought there'd be no interest from publishers. Unfortunately, that was the case, and we couldn't sell the book idea. But that turned around very, very soon after that. And whether Ann likes the books or not, the important thing is the attention has never ceased. In fact, it's continued to grow. And the fact that some of our most distinguished commentators, like Mark Kavinsiak, know so much about him, can speak so articulately, I think that's one of the greatest testimonials we have.
Go ahead, Ian.
I'm sorry. I just wanted to piggyback on what Mark just said. The program that Mark is talking about in Binghamton, New York, it's called The Fifth Dimension, and the entire fifth grade, all of the fifth grade classes watch the Twilight Zones and study them and learn about scapegoating and prejudice and mob mentality. And although these kids are only fifth graders, they really get this. And I said this in the book, I believe this would have been my dad's greatest accolade, to know that these kids are watching these shows and getting it.
The idea that they are talking, that these kids who were born, you know, whenever they were born in the 21st century, are learning about hate, mob mentality, things like that from watching The Monsters Are Due on Maple Street, I think would absolutely stun and delight him.
Right, and also the book that Mark Dewitziak, you're about to launch, Lessons from the Twilight Zone.
Well, and I'll add one other thing to that, because I sort of get to test this every semester, because I teach two courses a semester at Kent State University. And let me back up just for a second to make a point. The pop culture does not leave a lot on the shore. Every wave of the pop culture that comes in, it recedes, and it takes most of what was the pop culture at the time back out with it.
Very, very true.
Very, very little on the shore. So generation to generation, there are not touchstones for people that they identify. From the Beatles, you know, my daughter knows the Beatles as well as the Elvis, whether you like Elvis or not, Elvis, you're going to get Elvis at some point. You're going to get Star Wars at some point. People understand, may the Force be with you. But when you really look at the things that were big in each era, in each generation, there's very, very little that people understand. I say the name Columbo, which I wrote an entire book about to my students, not one of them recognizes the name.
Yeah.
Now, that was as big a show as there was, you know, and Peter won 5 Emmys for playing that part. It's gone, folks.
Yeah.
The Ant Griffith show is gone. This is a generation, one of the first generation that has not lived in Mayberry, that does not know what Mayberry is.
Yeah.
The Honeymooners was gone years before that. You could say bang, zoom to the moon, Alice, to somebody today, and they won't know you. You could be quoting an ancient Greek play as far as they're concerned. So the pop culture moves faster and faster, and it leaves little. There are two black and white television shows that my students still know and recognize. Only is I Love Lucy, iconically, and the other is The Twilight Zone. They're the only two. My students have lived and visited The Twilight Zone at one time or another. And we're talking about a black and white television show from now, we're getting close to 60 years.
With minimal production values, it just wasn't important.
It's the storytelling that endures. It is the storytelling that continues to endure and continues to work generation to generation. So it's one of the reasons we're still talking about Rod Serling, because The Twilight Zone continues to be one of the very few things that jump generation to generation. There's no mistake that there is a thrill ride at a major amusement park named for The Twilight Zone, named for this television series from antiquity.
And so there are a lot of songs called at least 3 or 4 songs called The Twilight Zone that have charted in the last 40 years.
That's right. And so that is one level of, you know, the relevance of those stories continue to speak to us. They continue. And the other thing that I have noticed is that in my job as a TV critic, I have interviewed practically every major showrunner of every acclaimed show of the last 38 years. Because when I started as a TV critic, Dallas was the number one show in America, and there were 3 networks. The name that keeps coming up over and over again, who influenced all of these writers who are writing these great cable dramas today, is Rod Serling. There is no close second. There is no close second in this field.
A while ago, Ann and Mark and I set out just to notice in a very informal way how often the phrase Twilight Zone appeared in the media, in newspapers, television, magazines, whatever. And we gave up very quickly because we were just overwhelmed by it. It has become a standard concept, a meme, to use the current terminology in American society.
Yeah. And you can use the iconic image of Rod Serling. You can use him in The Simpsons, you can animate him, and you can use him anywhere, and people will know who that is supposed to be. You can use him in a Saturday Night Live sketch, and people will know who it's supposed to be.
Yeah.
That's amazing. That's why The Twilight Zone is still relevant. It's why it's still alive. It's why it's going to continue to be alive. And as I have said before, I'll quote myself, it'll be relevant when we are staging plays in Alpha Centauri 200 years from now. Twilight Zone will still matter at that point.
Yeah, just to echo your earlier point, I know I had mentioned Project Gutenberg, which the books that are all online now for kids to get free, I had to go to a library and wait 2 or 3 weeks for something to become available when I was a child. And I tell my wife and I both write, and we're both very good writers, and I say, you want to know what's going to be the fate of the bad postmodern writers like a David Foster Wallace or people like a Jonathan Franzen who write glorified soap operas, or you want to know about the people who write the crap vampire books, just go to Project Gutenberg, because alongside of Mark Twain, alongside of Ambrose Bierce, alongside of Miguel Cervantes, you will find 10,000 times many more books and names of people who wrote the bestseller in 1898. Who wrote the bestseller in 1912. I remember just about a year ago reading something called like Betty Goes to College, and it's one of these really twee novels about, oh, a woman's going to college. Isn't that interesting? And this was a bestseller in 1908 or whenever it came out, and yet you look at it, I mean, it couldn't have been, by the 1920s, the jazz age, it must have been dated, and yet this woman was... well-known. She probably sold the equivalent of a blockbuster book back then. The second thing I wanted to talk about, I just mentioned just to end this, is, I've always lamented the loss of live television. I think that I had mentioned earlier, either in the interview or off camera, how the Newt Minow quote about the vast wasteland of television in the early 60s, which I think was a load of crap then. But I think that the internet is right about at that same point. 1960 and TV time is right about now, internet time. And I think there needs to be a Rod Serling person who, not necessarily as a writer, but as a writer combined visual medium, could come along and do, because we got web series that are these soap operas, we got web series that are sometimes educational and whatnot. But I don't know if you, Anne, or the people involved in Rod Serling books might want to look to people who submit 20 or 30 minute screenplays in a Serling-esque vein and have them produced on a YouTube, because that's the medium that you're going to reach young people. And if you have a junior high schooler or a high schooler, that they're going to be watching YouTube. They're not going to be watching the cable stuff.
Dan, we've already talked about this, and anybody watching who would like to give us a grant to produce these, we would happily accept it.
Yeah. So I just wanted to put that out.
Stay tuned.
Yeah. So let's just end this segment, and when we get back, we'll just wrap up, and I'll give each of you a final say-so, and we'll do that in just a moment. All right, let's wrap up this interview. It's been a long, but I think very enjoyable and very informative discussion on Rod Serling. And I know one of the reasons I do this is to get to these things, because there's more to life than just celebrity nipple slips and dancing squirrels online, or at least there should be. So let me go around the horn. Start with Mark Dowidziak. Let me just take a couple of minutes and say whatever you want to say about Rod Serling or future projects related to Rod or anything else you've got going on. Mark?
Well, I'll go back to where I started. I think that anybody who wants to pursue writing and storytelling would benefit from pursuing the path that leads through the Twilight Zone, leads through Rod Serling's career. And what you're going to discover is not just great storytelling and not just relevant storytelling, but you may just discover a hero in there as well. I did. And I know that many other writers who write television, from David Chase to Vince Gilligan, have said the exact same thing. So one of the reasons Rod Serling matters and will continue to matter. So I don't think anybody will be anything but rewarded for encountering the name Rod Serling.
Okay. Mark Olshaker, just so people know, I will have links to all relevant websites, to Ann's website, to the Rod Serling books and whatnot below this video. But if you want to give Mark Olshaker, maybe if you want to give out the Rod Serling address and then your closing thoughts.
I believe it's rodserlingbooks.com, isn't it, Ann?
Yes.
Yes. And we commend these books to all of you. You will not be disappointed to see how relevant these books written more than 40 years ago, some of them more than 50 years ago, how they absolutely still resonate with what's going on today. I would only end by saying that a week from tomorrow will be 40 years since Rod died, and there has not been any time during that time that I've not thought about him, not felt he was with me professionally and spiritually. I remember, you know, I didn't have the kind of relationship with him that Anne did, clearly, but I remember my grief, and I'll go further than that and say despair, when he died. And we, the three of us, are now significantly older than he was when he died, and yet we still look up to him as the primary figure, and I think he'll always be with us. And you know, I think that's one of the things that a legacy that that Anne and I share.
All right. Well, thanks, Mark. Anne, if you want to take us out, your final thoughts on your father, either personal, and also if you want to plug your website as well.
Well, there isn't a day that goes by that my father doesn't float across my mind. And I just also want to say that it's an honor to be with both Marks, who help fill in the missing pieces and who know so much about my dad's professional life, and Mark Olshaker, you know more about my dad's personal life too. This has been fun. And my dad would have been so surprised that here we are all these decades later talking about him, and I'm sure he would have had something self-deprecating, I'm sure, to say about that, right?
Well, I'll add one more thing if I can,
okay,
which is that I was first able to meet Rod because when he was president of the National Academy of Television Arts and Sciences, he came to my town to give a speech to the local chapter. And my mother was a producer, and my mother was a teacher by trade, had become a producer in one of the early educational radio stations here in Washington. So she was invited, and she took me. I was absolutely thrilled. So it was because of my mother that I was able to meet and become a close friend of Rod's. When my mother passed away, the first public outing I had was to drive up to Ithaca with my wife and go to this conference and meet Anne, and who I think we'd actually met once before, but we weren't sure. And so I met Rod through my mother, and right after my mother died, I met Anne, and I wonder if my mother got together with Rod and said, okay, we got to bring these two together now.
Well, I want to thank you all for your commentary on the life and career of Rod Serling, American television producer and television writer. I talked earlier about existentialism, and for those who enjoyed this conversation, my next interview will be the second of a three-part series I'm doing on the nature of existence. About a month ago, I interviewed an Episcopal bishop named John Spong. This coming Wednesday night, I'll be interviewing a philosopher named Tyron Goldschmidt, and we'll be talking about existence and everything. So I think Rod Serling would probably want to watch that one if he could. So again, thank you all three.
Thank you.